experience after months of webinar and video conferencing. Though I understand the environmental benefits of webinar and video conferencing, certainly I think this is much more exciting. Exciting because I have to look into your eyes and speak, which itself is exciting, and to interact with you physically. So thank you very much for coming and welcome again. And we'll do a round of introduction, but before that, let me introduce our partner, Ajay, please.
I'm Ajay Jakhad, work with Bharat Krishak Samaj, a farmers organization, which focuses on policy advocacy. And we're delighted to be here with iForest and Chandrabhushan ji. Thank you for agreeing to partner with us.
Thank you, Ajay. So we will do a round of introduction before our keynote speaker comes, and then we will start the program. So maybe we can start from here.
Good morning, everyone. I am Dr. Santosh Jain Pasi, Public Health Nutrition Consultant now, and former director, Institute of Home Economics, Delhi University. I am also the associate of Nutrition Foundation of India, one in the country, which was started by Dr. C. Gopalan, the father of nutrition in India. And luckily, I am honored to be one of his PhD scholars. I did my PhD under his guidance. And I'm also the honorary professor in public health nutrition at Amity University, Noida.
Thank you. Hi, good morning, everyone. My name is Ambu Chaturvedi. I represent a company called SVC Industries. We're based in Mathura, in Western UP, and we've just started working in the agri sector, where we're working with wheat and rice. So this is a learning experience for me. Nice to see all of you.
Hello, good morning, everyone. My name is Sudhir. I teach at Center for Political Studies, Jawaharlal Nehru University. I work on rural and agrarian issues. I also work with a small network called Rural and Agrarian India Network with some of the young researchers and students. I'm really happy to be a part of, as you said, a physical gathering where we don't need to switch off our camera or mute each other or something like that. So it's good to be back in action. Thank you and good to see you all.
Hi, I'm Bhavit and I'm Market Manager for Rainforest Alliance in India. And in India, we have been focusing on tea, coffee, spices, and now as a palm also. And palm, I have a special affinity because I started my career with a palm plantation in West Africa with Olam. So it's good to see how this development will happen in India.
Hi everyone, I'm Narin Mohan. I'm working with WWF India as Senior Specialist for Commodities and Forest. And within the commodities, I'm looking after sustainability in palm, timber, pulp, paper, and rubber and soya. Thank you.
Good morning, everyone. My name is Bhavya, and I work with an organization called Center for Responsible Business. Other than working on palm, we also work on circular economy, SMEs, etc. And I'm also representing, all three of us are founding members for the Sustainable Palm Oil Coalition. Thank you.
Hi, my name is Manu Kaushik, and I'm an ex-employee of GCMMF Limited, or Amul, as all of us would know. And I've sold oil as a sales manager, which was Dhara, which was a brand started by the National Dairy Development Board. I have recently written on edible oil in various publications, along with the former MD of Amul, Mr. B.M. Vyas. Thank you.
Good morning. My name is Krishna Sharma. I'm a corporate lawyer. My interest in being here is because I'm from Assam and very concerned about the government's plans to have palm oil all over the place in the northeastern states. So out of concern as a citizen.
Hi, I'm Vinakshi Sharma Dabas, and I am a corporate lawyer as well. I am partner with Corporate Law Group, and I head the nutrition business there. And I deal with a number of commodities, agricultural commodities like almonds, fortified rice, fortified rice, etc., and also finished products. So yes, my interest is to know about what is going on in the palm oil sector.
Morning, everyone. I'm Vishesh Uppal. I work for WWF India. I'm the Director of Governance, Law and Policy Program.
Good morning. My name is Raghu Nandan. I work with the Delhi Science Forum, which is an organization working on science and technology policy studies and advocacy. And we are part of a network of similar organizations throughout the country, currently about 38 such organizations, collectively called the All India People Science Network.
Good morning, everyone. I come from Northeastern Hill University. and sort of work on environmental ethics in the context of India's Northeast. And there's a huge concern about palm oil cultivation and this 11,000 crore rupees bonanza. Certainly we'll deliberate on this. My work pertains to Northeast India and European continental philosophy. Thank you.
Hi, good morning everyone. This is Orpo. I'm senior program associate for iForest for energy and climate change. Thank you.
Good morning everyone. I am Ganesh Shotri. I was associated with the Government of Rajasthan Agriculture Department, IFCO, and several other organizations. Basically, I am an agronomist. Since India is importing more than nearly 70% of the edible oil for our consumption, I am very keen to listen what alternatives are there in palm oil particularly, which largely we are importing soya and palm oil. So I am keen to listen to the prospects.
Good morning, everyone. I'm Nitin Verma with the High Commission of Canada. I'm the agriculture attaché there. And I just wanted to learn a little bit about this recent announcement and investment in India's foray into palm oil and of course, the audience's thoughts on that.
Good morning, everyone. I'm Abhay Goyal Desai from Ajanta Soya Limited. We're into palm oil and soybean oil and other edible oil manufacturing in India. And my reason to be here is to explore business opportunities and seeing the concerns of palm oil in the environment.
Good morning, everyone. I'm Anneli. I'm an expert at GIZ, the Technical Development Corporation of the Government of Germany, mainly relating to energy and climate topics.
Good morning, everyone. I'm Prachur. I'm a director at Socrates Foundation. And our job is to create deliberative spaces where people can actually collaborate to work together. And we have done a bunch of work around food systems, and this is a area of interest for us, so we're here to learn. And this is not my first physical meeting in the last few months, but still good to be a part of it.
Good morning, everybody. I'm Grishma, also from Socrates. Just an extension to the introduction that Prachur said, we had our convening with Ajay ji and Sunil Kumar ji last month. So nice to be here and open to learn.
Good morning, everyone. My name is Madhuri Nanda. I'm from Rainforest Alliance. I'm the director, South Asia. Here I'm also representing Sustainable Palm Oil Coalition India, which is actually looking at sustainable production of palm oil. And I'm really looking forward to hearing from the audience and also sharing my own perspectives and the coalition's perspective on sustainable growth of oil palm.
Good morning, everyone. My name is Manvi Singh, and I work as Program Manager for Energy and Climate Change at iForest.
Hi, good morning. I'm Prerna, and I'm a research associate with iForest. Thank you all for joining us today.
So, we actually have a very diverse group of people in this room, and our program also reflects that diversity. Now, there are some changes in the program that you have. One is that our keynote address will be given by Madam Shubha Thakur, who's Joint Secretary, Department of Agriculture and Farmer Welfare. And because of some urgent reasons, the secretary is not able to join us. So that's the first change, and I'm really happy that you're here. Similarly, Siraj Hussain Saab will not join us today to moderate session one. I will be moderating that session. And Dr. Sudhir Kumar Sutar, you will join session one. You were in session two. So we have tried to balance the participants in both the sessions. In session two, Ajay will moderate the session. And that's the change that is there. But essentially, both the sessions are divided in such a way that we have balanced opinion on both sides, for or against. We know that there is a difference of opinion on palm oil. And we need some sort of reconciliation, you can call it a balanced approach on the palm oil issue, and that's why we are here. Now, without much delay, we have our keynote speaker with us, and may I request her to put her point of view on the issue of risks and opportunities of palm oil cultivation in the country. Thank you.
Thank you, members on the dais, and
audience present. I'm really not aware about the composition of the audience, but like you were mentioning, it's a diverse composition. And so I'm representing the Ministry of Agriculture and Farmers Welfare. I'm Mrs. Shubha Thakur, Joint Secretary. I look after both all food grain crops and oil seeds and oil palm. So that's my portfolio over there. So I joined the ministry 2 years back, and ever since then we've been working hard on the oil palm issue. Just to give a brief background, as all of you may be knowing that since the last 30 years almost, we've been working on an oil palm program mission. It started way back in 1991, and we had lots of programs called Oil Palm Expansion Program, National Mission on Oil Palm and Oil Palm Research, and recently we had National Food Security Mission Oil Palm. But what we saw that despite a huge potential being available in India, the schemes were not taking off. Why the schemes were not taking off? So we had to delve deep down into all the reasons and come up with a unique scheme for the oil palm expansion. And so for the past 3 years, a lot of consultations have been held with all stakeholders. And all stakeholders meaning the oil palm farmers, the state governments, the industry, and also environment and all scientific researchers. So the government was very, very meticulous in its planning for the oil palm, and over the past 2 years we had discussions at various levels, at various forum, and the COVID did slow things down a bit, but we still kept on the discussions. So though the area which has been assessed for oil palm is around 28 lakh hectares, so this 28 lakh hectares has been assessed by the Indian Institute of Oil Palm Research, which is the key scientific research institution for oil palm in the country. It is an ICR institute. It's located in Pedivegi in Andhra Pradesh. So they have assessed this area for 28 lakh hectares, out of which 9 lakh hectares is fit for oil palm in the northeast alone. So questions have arisen regarding the assessment. Is it environment friendly? Will it take over forests? What is the assessment? How has it been made? So at the outset, I want to just clarify, there is no oil palm expansion being planned on any forest land. That's a big no. Whatever oil palm expansion is being planned is only going to be on land fit for cultivation of oil palm by either replacing crops such as rice or other crops, or on wasteland. In fact, we had a big business summit in the northeast recently in Guwahati, and the chief minister himself mentioned, Arunachal chief minister, that quelling any kind of thoughts on the oil palm being going to take away forests, that it will only be done on the wastelands or taking away some other crops which are already water guzzling. So this is at the forefront. I want to tell you all that there will be no oil palm cultivation taking away any forest land. And this survey was done over a year and a half, and they also took the help of the Soil Land Use Survey of India, SLUSI, and it was done with all the states' participation. So that 28 lakh hectares, we have a two-phase program in that, 19 lakh hectares, and the rest will be done later, and it will take into all the considerations of environment, rain-fed conditions. So that is to begin with. What is the present area today? A meager 3.5 lakh hectares is the only area which is under cultivation of oil palm. So we have to rectify that. We have to speed it up if we want to really speed up the oil palm program in India. And out of the 3.5 lakh hectares, the fruiting area is still very less. So we have to work out a policy how to not only increase the oil palm expansion, but also ensure that it sustains. And the fruit, whatever fruiting comes, should also go into the oil palm production, and that the fruit bunch should not be thrown away. That would be even more criminal than that. First of all, have it and just throw it away. So that ecosystem has been created by us, which I will explain. So the area I have explained, about 28 lakh hectares. To begin with, it is 19 lakh hectares. And for the oil palm mission, which is called the National Mission on Edible Oil Palm, which has been approved by the cabinet, which has an outlay of 11,000 crores, for this, we have kept a target of 6.5 lakh hectares. So from the present 3.5 lakh hectares, we intend to go up to 10 lakh hectares by 25-26. So we're not just going to, you know, do it rapidly. It's in a phased manner. So 6.5 lakh hectares is the target which we have kept for the National Mission on Edible Oil Palm. Out of those 6.5 lakh hectares, around 3.2 lakh hectares is for the rest of India, which means not the Northeast. And for the Northeast, we have kept for 3.28 lakh hectares. So Northeast is around that, 3.22 and 3.28 lakh hectares. So that is the mission, how we planned it. How did we come to these numbers? We had talks with the state governments, we had talks with the processors. So this area, who was interested? Because, you know, this oil palm system, ecosystem only works if you have a good tripartite arrangement with the state government, the farmers and the processors. Otherwise, it will not work. If one, cog falls out of this wheel, it doesn't work. So it has to be, the whole ecosystem has to work like this. So the target is 6.5 lakh hectares. In this mission, the most important demand which was there from the stakeholders was regarding the prices for the fresh fruit bunches from which the oil is extracted. So everywhere we used to go, we had talks with farmers in the Northeast. I personally went in the South to Karnataka, to Andhra, to Telangana, and all the farmers just used to ghirao me and say, you have to give me the prices. We've been very fortunate in the past one and a half years, the palm oil prices are running very high in the international markets. So the prices have gone up and the farmers are getting good prices for their produce. But a time may come that the prices will not be so good. So the first and foremost, the farmers wanted an assurance for their produce that if I do grow this crop, will I get the prices? Because it's I invest so much, I give so much time, the fruits come after 4 years, but then it goes up to 30 years. So we said, so this is the first problem which we tackled. So what has the government done to assure the farmers of the prices? We've introduced a concept called the viability price. So the viability price would be the price payable to the farmers by the government, which will be assured price to the farmers. And this we will fix based on a transparent formula, which we have formulated after discussion with the stakeholders and all the state governments. And this viability price we will announce on the 1st of November of every oil palm year, beginning this year itself. So once the farmer knows, okay, I will get X for my fresh fruit bunch, for my produce, then he knows beforehand that he will get this money no matter what. No matter what meanings, he doesn't have to bother about volatility of international prices. He doesn't have to bother about the oil extraction rate of the FFBs, because in the fresh fruit bunches, you have maybe within one bunch itself, you have varying rates of oil extraction. And that is a cumbersome process of weighing and everything. So we have dissociated the fresh fruit bunch price from both these factors and assured the farmer that you will get this viability price based on the formula which the government has adopted. So this is the first thing. The second thing which we have done is fix a formula price. Earlier there was a CACP formula price. The CACP formula price was a complex formula price of 13.54% plus 9% of palm kernel and complicated formula. What we have done, we have said the formula price will be 14.30% of CPO. So we have one viability price, one formula price. Both has been fixed by the government. And if the viability price works out to be 10,000 and formula price works out to be 8,000, the government of India will give that 2,000 rupees to the farmer to assure him the viability price. That is an assurance for that the budget has been kept. And the budget has been kept not till 25-26, but the assurance has been given up to 2037 also. So the viability price minus formula price, the farmers will get the viability gap funding from the government of India. So this is the most innovative scheme which we have come out with. And the farmers will be rest assured of the prices, no matter what the industry pays him, no matter what the international prices are, no matter what. For the industry also, we've kept a formula. The industry will start with 14.3% to begin with, up to 7 years. and it will go up to 15.3% in November 2037. So November 2037 is a sunset clause. We are saying we will pay the farmers up to 2037 November. So, and by that time we know that the industry will also invest a lot. The FFB yields will increase, the productivity will increase because of our interventions. So this is how we've kept the sunset clause in November 2037. And like I mentioned, the government has already budgeted up to 2526 for the viability price, then viability gap funding. And we have also kept the assurance that up to 2037, this government will give the viability gap funding. We could budget beyond that because the scheme is up to 2526. That's how the government works. So after that, the next scheme will take care of the period beyond 2526. So this is the viability price, formula price. And for this, a committee has already been constituted by the government. We've already met a couple of times. We have stakeholders from economic affairs, from revenue, from customs, from our own ministry. So as I mentioned, the formula price will be 14.3% of CPO. Now, another question arose, what CPO price to take? Because there are varying CPO prices, where, considering where they land. The landed prices are different in different ports. So we looked at the figures of the past 3 years and we saw that the most of the CPO is traded on the Kandla exchange, the Kandla port, through the MCX exchange. So we have taken the CPO price to be taken as the MCX exchange at Kandla port because majority is done there. So for the purposes of this scheme, the CPO will be taken from the MCX traded at Kandla port. So this is, and the industry also has to take that when they pay the farmers. So this is the Kandla, and why we came to 14.3%, you would ask. What was the rationale of 14.3% of CPO? We saw the prices being paid to the farmers by the Andhra government, because Andhra is 80% of the FFB market. So Andhra government, we took the last 3 years average, what the FFB prices were being given to the farmers. And mind you, those FFB prices being given to the farmers was based on the old CACP formula. So we took those prices and we saw what percentage of it came as CPO. And that percentage average came as 14.3. So questions have been raised to us that in your new formula, you're not taking palm kernel, you're only taking CPO. But just to clarify, since we have taken the 14.3 of CPO based on the 3 years average of Andhra Pradesh, which is based on the CACP formula, so obviously we've taken care of all the elements, we've just simplified it. And it's 14.3 of CPO. So that's the 14.3% logic, how we've taken it. So this is the viability price, formula price. The industry has to pay 14.3% to begin with for the first 7 years. And then after that, we have increased their share. It goes to 15.3, and the government comes down to zero in November 2037. For the Northeast, the government will absorb an extra 2% because the Northeast has lower yields and the farmers are getting less prices, and we want the Northeast farmers to be at par with the rest of India farmers. In the business summit we had in Guwahati, the biggest complaint, and because we had interactions with farmers from all the Northeastern states and from Andhra and from Telangana, and they were very discouraged. They were saying they get 10, 12 rupees, we get 5 rupees per kg. So then we explained to them that in this scheme it's been made fair. You will get the same price of FFB as your counterpart in the rest of India. And we will also, the government of India will absorb that extra 2% for Northeast India. So that's how far ahead the government has planned for this scheme. Coming to the budget, you'll be surprised to know that for the last 5 years, our budget on oil palm was a meager 300 crore for the whole 5 years. Around 300 crore allocated and even less was spent. The government has made this into 11,040 crores for the next 5 years. That's the quantum jump we have taken in the budget. So this shows the seriousness of the government for the oil palm mission. And in that 11,040 crore, the viability gap funding is also included. of course, the viability gap funding may not be needed, but we have to factor in keeping a certain trend and percentage. So I hope it's not needed. I hope the farmers get the prices as it is for their produce. But of course, we've kept the viability gap funding also around 3,000 crores viability gap funding provision, which we have kept. So the budget is a quantum jump from 300 to 11,000 crores. So, and we explained to the farmers that this is the seriousness of the government. So if now the state governments don't come forward, help us, they have to make this work. This whole scheme will only work if the state governments and the processors and the farmers sit down and talk and have the scheme in place. Of course, we are there to play the role of catalyst. We are there to iron out any differences, and that we are doing. We have meetings almost every week at higher levels. VCs, business summits are being organized all through the country. We just had one in Guwahati. We're having another one on 18th November in Hyderabad. So the second one is coming up in Hyderabad. So this has been worked out. The scheme has...
Address some of the contentious issue, including how you are defining wasteland in Northeast, or the water issue that is of a lot more interest to the group.
So I don't have all the scientific inputs on the wasteland, but the report which was made by the Indian Institute of Oil Palm Research has gone into all these soil and water aspects and come out with that. Regarding the water issue, it's often said that palm oil is a very, it's a enormous water guzzling crop also. In this mission, we have made it mandatory that any palm oil which will be put up has to be through micro irrigation, drip irrigation. It has to be through that. And in fact, extra budget has been kept for that for the Northeast also. If you see in Andhra, Telangana, already 99% is drip irrigation. And contrary to belief, the palm oil does not take more water than rice. It does not take more water than rice. In fact, and in a rice system, it takes even 1/4 of the water. So it's not that rice is better or palm oil is less. That's not the case, as my scientists have told me. So this is, I want to put that right in the front, that it is not a more water guzzling crop, and we are insisting on drip irrigation, and it's already there in Andhra and Telangana, if you see, and for the Northeast also. The second issue regarding how it affects the environment and destroys the soil, we have kept extra provisions for cultivation such as half moon terrace, for vermicomposting, and we are not introducing palm oil as a monocrop. We are going to introduce palm oil with intercropping in the first 4 or 5 years, because as you know, the crop starts giving fruits only after 5 years, and after 7 years the returns start coming. So we are not promoting monoculture in palm oil. The intercropping assistance has been enhanced quite a lot, and also the maintenance. We have separate funds for vermicomposting, for half moon terrace, for land clearance, for biofencing. All that has been kept. So, and this I can tell you, and lots of budget has been kept for that. So in the Northeast, the environment will not be destroyed, I can assure you that. In fact, they are more aware of the environment than I am. The local people are more aware, and they will definitely not allow some crop to come up which will destroy the environment, I am sure. And we discussed this in detail in the summits also. And the palm oil gives a lot of return as compared to other oilseed crops. Although the government has a complementary policy of oilseeds and palm oil, but the palm oil gives 4 to 6 times more oil than any other oilseed crop. And you need much more land for oilseed crop than for palm oil to produce the same amount of oil. And all of you know, India is very dependent upon oil. And we have an issue of pleasing the consumers also. The consumers want their oil. You see, if the oil prices rise, how much human cry is there? Sarso ka daam 200 rupiah ho gaya, iska daam wo ho gaya. My colleague from MAFED is here. He's there every weekend. We attend these meetings. So the consumers want oil. Of course, we have a policy of trying to maintain the consumption also at a fixed 19 kilogram per person per year, but I cannot control that. So our import bill is 80,000 crore rupees. And who are we paying? we are paying the farmers of Indonesia and Malaysia. So our farmers, if they have scope to produce palm oil on our land without destroying the environment, by replacing even water guzzling crops such as rice and others, what is the harm? It's a good policy. We will be saving good foreign exchange, and we will also be assuring the farmers of a long income. So in fact, in Andhra, the saying is that if you just have to bear for the first 3 years, and you'll get 30 years of returns on the crop. So that also has to be seen. So these are some issues, and the rest, like I said, the government has, it's not an unending scheme. We have come to a sunset clause also. It's been thought of like that, and we hope that the scheme would take off. And but again, like I said, the state governments have to play a very important role. They are instrumental in giving the land for the nurseries, for the seed gardens, for the oil palm mills. So because all the most of the seed sprouts are imported right now, most of them, so we have to become self-sufficient in our own gardens, in the oil palm sprouts, and it gives a lot of employment generation. It creates a lot of jobs. An oil palm mill is created, roads are made, infrastructure is there, FPOs are made. It brings prosperity to the region. So it's a whole system we are developing. And I personally think that we should wheel away from rice, the rice wheat, the rice belt, and have more power in those areas like Telangana is doing. Of course, there has been criticism about depleting the water table in Andhra, but then we want to focus more on the rain-fed areas. So Northeast is good for that. Rain-fed system is there, so it's good for the it's good like that. So with these words, I mean, I think I have given enough of the scheme and the thoughts of the government, and the government has come up with an innovative idea of viability gap funding, and my ultimate stakeholder is only the farmer. This whole scheme is for the farmer. It's a win-win for him. The processors have a role to play, state governments have a role to play, but my only and ultimate stakeholder is the farmer who I'm looking after. And the budget has been keeping him in mind. Thank you.
Thank you. The few issues that just I would like to ask, was there a consultation with Ministry of Environment under the scheme?
Yes, all the stakeholders. Yes.
Okay. Yes. Because we were asking Ministry of Environment mm-hmm. if they had some position on this issue, and they came back essentially saying that they have not intervened on this issue. And
Ministry of Environment said
yes.
I don't know who you interacted with in Ministry of Environment, but so I can't comment.
Okay.
Yes.
So, but overall, I think the government has thought through the program. And
just to clarify, the Ministry of Environment is part of the government, and this has been cleared by the cabinet.
Okay.
The scheme.
Sure. So, essentially, it has been thought question they can ask you before you leave. Okay. Two questions, and then, please. So, Manu is there.
Yeah. Now, what is the yield per hectare in the existing palm oil as of now, which is happening in Andhra Pradesh? As per my calculations, I thought it was 1.2 tons per hectare.
Actually, it varies, but you're right. We don't have the maximum yield, which should be 4 to 6. It's around 2, yes. So that's what we're addressing through better technology, through better planting material, through proper management of the crop. So,
but even our mustard oil yield is pretty less compared to the world standard.
No, world standard, if you compare, because although we are focusing in the mustard oil, we're focusing on high yielding varieties of seeds. That's my other portfolio which I have. And if you see last year, we've produced a lot and the yields have also gone up. But the mustard crop in other countries are also GM varieties. So we don't have that here. But we have scope for improvement. And we're focusing upon the higher yields for mustard also, and all crops.
Trying to bring across is that the difference in yield is not 10 times, the gap is not that big, because in Andhra Pradesh we are at 1.2 or 2 tons, and our present mustard oil is at around 400 per hectare. So it is 3 or 4 times higher, not 10 times as per the press release of the government of India. So I think probably that can be worked upon.
So I think the lady there is there at the back.
Thank you, Joint Secretary. Actually, we learned quite a bit about the plans. Now, I'm from Assam. I practice here, but I'm from Assam. And I think with regard to Assam, I have 2 points to make. One is, you know, about sustainability and a way of life. And I see palm oil as actually changing that, which is a great worry. Because what we are proud of in our villages is, you will see prosperity of a different kind. It's sustainable prosperity. It is not much. People have fish in the pond. They have the rice, their own rice. And you know, oil is so minimal, we don't have oil. I mean, Delhi aake, I am having oil, but otherwise we don't have oil. So that's one. The second is that who is the farmer there? We are very concerned that this is actually going to lead to Malaysia-like farming, where it's not farmers anymore, it's corporations. And that is a very significant worry in the Northeast, that you'll change the landscape and the ecosystem. It's already happening. It's already happening. Okay. We see the changes in the last 7 years.
Okay.
We had discussions with your state government in detail, and I don't know why you get the impression it's going to be something like Malaysia or Indonesia. Malaysia and Indonesia is only monocropping. We are not propagating that. We have kept the farm in mind. We have the intercropping. We have integrated farming concepts for the farmers, where they can have goats, they can have fishery, they can have. So it's not going to be that model. And of course, we're in talks with the state governments. So I don't want to answer all the larger issues about the eco and what the government, we are talking in with them already.
But thank you very much for coming on this short notice. Ajay.
Can I just suggest, ma'am, ki jo aapka jo panel bana hai for, you know, that way you will be meeting early on deciding the price, if you could have a farmer also on that panel with all the industrialists and the economists.
No, we have economists from economic affairs. And actually, the government is going to 100% fund that. So the farmer's interest, like I said, is topmost. They don't need to worry about a farmer being present on that panel. Don't have to worry about that. We'll take care of their interests.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Okay. So give her a big hand, please. Okay. Yeah. May I invite the panelists for the first session, please? Okay. So we are not breaking right now. Okay. So Dr. Ashok, please. Manu Kaushik and Sudhir, please. Come.
Conventional oil seeds, let's just focus on oil. I think both these should happen simultaneously. Then we will be getting closer to the target that we are talking of, is to reduce our import bills. And the point that Manu made is absolutely correct, to properly assess the demand for input.
Sure. Thank you. Thank you. The challenge after three wonderful speakers is that you don't know what to say, because many points have already been said. So I'll try to just put up throw some points here. One is that I think we still have not learned from our mistakes of what we call as the Green Revolution. And I could see that the logic which has been floated here is that this is one panacea which is going to solve the problems related to oil consumption and going to reduce our import bill. And it is taken as if this is something given, that one short solution will actually solve all the problems. We heard similar logics of Green Revolution, and we see what kind of environmental implications, societal implications it has on Indian society. And one of the problem was, which was highlighted by previous speakers, is that we do not have an integrated policy mechanism to look into various aspects. And that brings me to the next point. I don't know if anybody has seen, I have not been able to find an access to the report of Indian Institute of Oil Palm, which actually recommended this kind of cultivation. It says that it actually talked about the agricultural viability of oil palm, not the ecological viability. Now, what kind of ecological viability was discussed? I think at least people have a right to know what inputs came into it. That's one. Secondly, when we talk about policy paradigms, I think there are intended consequences and there are unintended consequences of such policy shifts. Now, intended consequences could be that there could be an increase in growth of production and blah, blah, blah. But what about the unintended consequences? I again refer here, look at the whole idea of rice cultivation and the way government supported wheat and rice-based model in 1960s and 1970s. Today, it is working hard to do away with that mechanism and it is unable to do it despite all the efforts. And the sunset clause is being referred as if it is something very easy to implement and withdraw after 10 years. I think that's like living in a dream world and not looking at the realities. When I say unintended consequences, what I mean is, and previous speaker did highlight some of the points, the impact on small and marginal farmers. Now, there are three major stakeholders which are being referred here. One is industry, second is farmers, and third is the government. Now, the category of farmers is being taken as a given category, and we know it is a very difficult category to measure, and one of the participants highlighted that, you know, which farmer are we talking about when we are discussing here. And I think we need to make a distinction between industry, large farmers, and small and marginal farmers. And I really wonder why there is a harm when government is floating a policy to acknowledge that it is actually talking about the industrial interests, instead of, you know, referring to farmer and then protecting the industrial interests. What brings me to the point is that in case of Africa, for example, for palm oil cultivation and in order to ensure its environmental sustainability, there are enough checks and balances which have been brought in to ensure that its impact on environment should be checked along with other mechanisms which should be in place. But it can be done only in case of industry. You can't do it in case of small and marginal farmers or large farmers if they adopt a similar agricultural model. Now, and again, I would refer, this actually happened in case of rice and wheat, when beyond a point, it actually became difficult for government to monitor it and to supervise it. So its impact on small and marginal farmers, it's not about what kind of benefit they would be getting. Rather, look at the kind of rural inequality and disparity it will produce. That there is a crop which is giving benefit to one group of farmers in a village who are large farmers, and the small and marginal farmers are not able to get access to the similar kind of crop due to different reasons. Now, the issue of rural inequality and disparity which it will produce, you know, we don't actually consider it when we are talking about policy paradigm. Finally, the recommendation here I would put forward is that when government is talking about stakeholders, I think in policy it should explicitly state that this is meant for industry, this is meant for large farmers, and finally it should say this is what is there for small and marginal farmers, instead of clubbing all these conceptual categories together, naming it farmer welfare, and then coming up with a different kind of agenda. I think that this not only harms the interest of farmers, it actually harms the interest of the industry as well. So I think it's better to be honest, it's better to be explicit, so that we can actually mitigate, minimize the side effects of a policy, as we have witnessed in case of Green Revolution in 1960s. And today we are reaping, you know, the negative benefits of Green Revolution. I'll stop here. Thank you.
Thank you. I think the maximum question is going to go to Dr. Ashok. Because I thought that my colleagues have brought some balance in terms of pros and cons. But it looks like 3-1 right now. That's what the panel looked like. But I am going to therefore work with him, okay, to ask questions from you, so that there is some sort of, you know, balance in discussion. But let me start with you, Dr. Ashok. The points made here is that we are consuming 26 million tons of edible oil. That data is available. The data also is that, our total oil
consumption is okay.
Yeah, our total oil consumption is, edible oil consumption is 26 million tons, of which anywhere between 55% to 60% we import. These are factual issues. Whether we are consuming in households, or we are consuming to make namkeen, or we are giving it to detergent and industry is a different issue. But 26 million ton is what we consume. We are importing 80,000 crore rupees worth of oil. Now, The government has a valid point to say that why am I importing so much? This consumption is there. This is a latent, not latent, this is actual consumption. You know, latent consumption will be, you know, there's different way to define what is latent consumption. But actual consumption is this, we are importing this. If I am importing from Indonesia and Malaysia and there are land which is suitable for palm oil cultivation in this country, then what is wrong in starting a process of palm oil in small scale? Right now they are talking about 2.8 million hectares, starting with 1 million hectare right now. What is wrong in starting an experimentation process and then see, and then they are talking about sunset clause. So they have actually, in many ways, have covered their base. So what is wrong in it? Let me start with Raghu. I'll come to Dr. Ashok later. Raghu, what is wrong in starting? And 2.8 million hectare, by the way, will be about 0.1% of India's geographical area. Okay, we are 330 million hectares, right? So what is wrong in it?
First point that I would like to make is, this is not a new experiment. The work on oil palm has been going on since past 20 years, more in the case of the Little Andaman Islands. We've got 235,000 hectares of land in which oil palm is being cultivated, mostly in Andhra, Telangana, Tamil Nadu, etc. So, I am speaking from data thrown up by our actual experience till now. So, it's not something imaginary which is now being projected. Let's try and see what's going on. We have tried and seen, and the experience has shown us something, and my comments therefore are made on that behalf. Second point is that, like you correctly said, the demand-supply equation, the money outgo for import is no. Why is it that the answer to that question has to be only oil palm? That is my poser. We know that there is an imbalance. We are importing oils. We are spending a lot of money. There are many solutions to this problem. Increasing productivity of conventional oil seeds, which the Agriculture Ministry itself is talking about, but to sell this project, that part has been underplayed. To say, nahin, wo to ho hi nahi sakta, it cannot be done, this is as he hai, you know, etc. So that's one solution. Second solution is, as I said, do oil palm if you want, but do it where you are going to get the best results. Right now, you assume that you will get the best results. You're doing it in areas where 10 years of experience has shown that your productivity is 1.4. tons per hectare, which is what you're getting from soybean or sunflower or whatever. So I'm saying do a proper study, see where you can get actual good yields without recourse to groundwater. I'll emphasize that. Much has been said about this is not a thirsty crop, etc. 250 liters per tree per day. I would say that's a pretty thirsty animal or tree that is. Ensure that you're not using groundwater. Choose areas where you can actually get good yields and productivity. For example, substitute for existing plantation crops, coconut, banana, whatever. If paddy areas are being supplanted, that raises another set of questions. So choose the areas where you think you can get the best results. Match all your parameters regarding the different...
But Raghu, why do you think they have not chosen the best area?
Because there is no selection process involved here, in the sense that it's a, you have said in this area, in so and so regions, Andhra Pradesh, they have said look for irrigated areas. 60% of areas which talk about as potential for oil palm tend to be paddy areas. Okay, so because that's where you get water, either you get irrigation
or you get groundwater.
Or you do groundwater, and groundwater has its own problems.
Okay.
So, my point is that we know the problem. You stated the problem, this much demand, this much import, etc. Why do we assume that there is only one solution?
Okay. Okay. Dr. Ashok, to you now.
Sorry, one final small point,
yeah.
Just in a sentence. We also have seriously under-exploited non-edible oils in our country, which also has a huge import bill, by the way, which can be used for these non-edible purposes of industries, soaps, etc., which we are underestimating.
Can you just expand it a little bit?
See, we have about 26 different varieties of non-edible oils, tree-borne oils, in forests, growing in the wild, the green trees going around. The extent of that availability, we have not tapped at all. Which can be tapped, we have not looked at it at all. And these non-edible purposes, not your namkeens, etc., but soap making and so on and so forth, lubricants industry, can use a lot of non-edible oils, which we are not yet seriously looking at in this country.
So the point, Dr. Ashok, which is coming from the other two panelists, is that you are overestimating the productivity of palm oil. It's not what we are going to get. In fact, the point is that if 1.4 ton per hectare is what we are getting from palm oil, then the average of other oil seed is also about the same. So where is the land and economic advantage of palm oil?
Well, I think I'm thankful to all the panelists.
They have raised very pertinent question, but they have flagged the right questions, and let me also answer one by one, all three. But of course, I myself, because Shubha was referring to one report of CACP, she referred to this, and in all humility, I was author of that report. That is still on the website of the CACP. And before giving that report, I was the lead author, and then Ashok Gulati, another agriculture economist, we jointly made a report. He was the second. But the point is, we thoroughly made a study by going to East Godavari and many parts of Andhra, then Northeastern. The short point I want to make it, crop has a cycle of almost 30 years. So initial 4 years, there is no fruit, and then they slowly grow. And after 7 years, when we say 4 to 6 tons of oil per hectare, that means we are talking of the fully mature. That means between 7 and 27 years, because in the last 3 years also, the productivity goes down. And in the initial years also, it's like a human cycle. When a child is small, then he's not as productive as he becomes a young adult, and then his productivity also reduces when he becomes a little bit old. So similarly, we have thoroughly studied, and a fully matured FFB, they give this kind of thing. And we have talked to not the institute we are referring to in the pedagogy, but to the farmers also. That is point one. And second, because I have soiled my hands in the government working, and it is necessary, not many people perhaps know, it seems, that it is, whether you like it or not, each ministry, when it prepares a cabinet door, mind you that this particular scheme, 11,000 crore worth of this scheme was approved by cabinet, and it's necessary, and nobody can wish away. It requires the approval of all the concerned ministry, including the Ministry of Environment and Forest. I'm 100% sure on this, and this is the necessary condition, otherwise cabinet will not consider, even leave aside approve or disapprove. So the Ministry of Environment, I think you also raised it, and that points were taken, and they have seen from all angles whether this is feasible or not. And because they have not touching the forest area and all those areas where farmers are cultivating some crop of this, that is good. So this point.
And so just want to add here, where is the wasteland in Northeast? I have not understood that. What is wasteland in Northeast?
I can't answer this wasteland, but I know there are lands on which some cultivation is.
Of course, there's jhoom cultivation. We have
about a million
hectares. So.
And that 1 million hectare, because some authors say, like K.L. Chadda, he also brought out a report. He said 2 million. Pedagogy, that institute, we have visited that. We have a detailed discussion with that some time back before CACP brought out its report. And so 1 million hectare is the conservative estimate. And it is going to be in the phased manner. It's not that in one go they will do it. It will be done in a phased manner. Then let me tell you that there is a substantial difference in the productivity of other edible oils. And let me again, even at the cost of repetition, 26 million hectares give just 7 million tons of edible oil. Now see this. And similarly, and we have worked out about 15.8 million hectares of land will give about 4 million tons of palm oil. Now the question arises, why not palm oil? See, I mean, let me give another analogy. Suppose a person is sick, he needs some medicine. But the medicine also gave a caveat in a very small, finer print that its side effect ye hai. Still we take, because otherwise we will die. Now what are the options? Otherwise you depend too much on this. So it's like, otherwise I might die, and on other, at least I survive.
Okay. that analogy is a little...
but the point is, in the COVID has shown us that we can't depend too much on the foreign sources.
Okay. Okay. Manu, you know, you have worked on other oilseed. Okay. Now, there's absolutely, now it is quite clear to me from this panel discussion as well as what I have read, that there is difference in opinion on productivity of other oilseed versus palm oil in terms of what is going to happen in this country. Now, if suppose the same package of palm oil is given to other oilseed, will that bring some sort of parity in the development of oilseed in this country?
So definitely, I think that is what we have written. We have said that we need an oil mission for all edible oils, not just for palm oil. And why should we just focus on anyone? Our objective is to be Atmanirbhar in edible oil and reduce our import bill and give income to farmers. And we should look at something which does that irrespective of the crop. Right? So while palm oil has a higher yield per hectare and is probably easy way out, it is the government says it is 10 times the yield of mustard. Their records show it is around 3 times. But if you work on mustard or groundnut, we can increase the yield, and you know, so we can go down to equality, parity, or say that twice the yield of mustard. So yeah, so there is no issue on the yield difference. Definitely on less land you can have more oil in palm oil. But the gap is not as high as the government says, which is 10 times.
Okay. Now, today, I don't know how many of you saw the newspaper article where Mr. Nitin Gadkari said that you must print in block letters and bold letters that this oil contains palm oil. He was speaking to a industry association of soya oil producers. And this is an issue which is also there at the Food Safety Authority, that, you know, if you are using palm oil, even 30-40%, you must mention it. Why do you think the palm oil industry or the oil producers are reluctant to put that in bold letters?
So actually that would just kind of upset the whole apple cart. If you look at the various oil brands, when you have Saffola, the brand name came from safflower oil, which is curdy oil, which is one of the healthiest oils. So usse aapka Saffola bana brand. Now if you buy Saffola, there are two or three variants of Saffola. One is Saffola Total, one is Saffola Gold. So in one of them there is no safflower, it is zero. You have 70% rice bran, 30% soybean, I think. In a different variant, which is Saffola Gold, you have 70% rice bran, 30% safflower oil. So that goes against the whole brand ethos. But the consumer is buying Saffola because he thinks he's buying safflower or curdy oil. Similarly, if you look at Sundrop by ITC, it was supposed to be sunflower oil. But is it sunflower oil? So you have, then there are 5 variants, you have to search how much sunflower oil is there in each variant. Now Fortune does a wonderful thing, it is Fortune, so it is not sunflower, it is not Sundrop, it is not this.
Right? So anyway, so the point is the whole industry works on blending, and that is the whole game of refining.
Triple refining.
Yeah, so when earlier we used to have oil, it used to be filtered oil. Filtered oil is just crushing the oil seed and filtering it through a sieve. So that is basic filtered oil. Then you have the process of refining, which does something called solvent extraction, in which the aroma, the taste, the flavor, the smell, everything of the oil, the color is taken out. And then all the oils are same. And then you can blend the oils. And you can see that by, you know, then it doesn't really matter which oil you are selling. You blend it with the cheapest oil and you reduce the price in the market, and all the brands then compete on prices. And now it's a game of prices. Now nobody really knows what oil he's making the food with. And that is why we should go back to filtered oils and not say...
I think that we will discuss in the next panel. We have people from nutrition and others who will discuss the palm oil and other issues. Okay. I mean to say, why do you say that this mission cannot, small and marginal farmers can't benefit out of it? You know, the same argument was made for social forestry, for example. If you look at today, Punjab and Haryana has no forest, but they're the largest producer of wood in the country. And they're largely produced by small and marginal farmer at the outskirt of. So why do you think palm oil will not benefit small and marginal farmer?
First thing is that the requirement of the kind of cultivation which it requires. I think for small and marginal farmer, it is difficult to go for multi-cropping, which the government has been arguing. And
but can you go for multi-cropping? I'll come back to that, but I'm asking you, is multi-cropping a viable option with palm oil? I have not seen any multi-cropping in Indonesia and Malaysia.
No, similarly, in case of Africa, for example, there were experiments for multi-cropping which miserably failed. So multi-cropping is, I don't know from what experiment and what kind of facts are produced to support this argument, but I think it's not a feasible option. When multi-cropping is not a feasible option, the only answer is that you go for a monocropping based on palm oil. Now, if you have monocropping in place, it can have two kind of impact. Number one, what sir you were suggesting, that number one, you have to have an expectation of just gestational period of 4, 5, 6 years, whatever you are saying. Now, for a small and marginal farmer, I think having an expectation of waiting for 5 years, it's too much to expect. That is number one point. The second point I would like to mention here is, and you know, Ajayvirji would second it here. You look at the rice cropping in Punjab, for instance. Now, it has been extremely difficult for the government even to convince farmers to delay the plantation of rice when the monsoon season begins. Now, what I wonder is, when government is saying that they will keep a check on these things and they will have a mechanism to ensure that it is based upon drip irrigation, what are the mechanisms which are being put in place to ensure that? Now, it means that it is all this is in air, that there will be a mechanism. And finally, if you allow me to say one more point. For example, in case of Africa, now there is a there is our sustainability norms which are being developed called Roundtable on Sustainable Palm Oil, where there are different measurements which have to be followed by the industry. So that means that you can keep a check, as you mentioned just now in case of Mr. Nitin Gadkari's statement, that what is being produced by industry, whether it is sustainable or not. But when it is being produced by large farmers, what can be that mechanism? Because you don't have any specific chain which is being followed when large farmers are producing palm oil. And similarly, when it goes to small and marginal farmers, for example, is there a process to keep a check? I think we don't have. We don't have it even till date for wheat and rice. How can we expect that after 5-7 years we will have something in place for palm oil? And this brings me to the last point, that I think it is essential, it is necessary that government should make a distinction between palm oil cultivation for industry, for large farmers, and for small and marginal farmers. And they should actually try to come up with a mechanism where the requirements of three sectors are kept in mind. And finally, I think we need to think in terms of enhancing the value chain of the existing oil seeds also, which was highlighted that it remains untapped. What about our own cosmetic products, which are the traditional Indian cosmetic products? They have not received so much of support from government as has been the case with the products based upon palm oil. So I think that could be one area where government should focus on, other than, you know, simply encouraging the existing products based on palm oil. I'll stop.
Okay,
thank you.
Let me come back to the second last question, and I'll go to Manu and Raghu for a few more comments. There was a comment made by Raghu, which was essentially that why not look at palm oil on existing plantation? Okay, I mean to say, see, tree plantation is dying across Karnataka now. We have large tea plantation area in Karnataka. So has government looked at existing plantations for palm oil to replace tea, for example? Tea is, if you go to Assam today, many of the tea plantations are in losses. They want to sell it off, or they are taking the tea trees out. Is palm oil plantation possible on those plantations?
Well, I'm not very sure on this technicality of this.
But my understanding is not, because that 1 million hectares we are talking of is 3.5, basically we are talking of 6.5 lakh hectares, of which 3.5, total 1 million hectare, and 3.5 is already covered. So to my understanding, that is not explored as of now. So they want the existing farmers' land, they should switch over to palm oil, and that area has been identified, not on the tea plant, to the best of my understanding.
Okay, let me come back to Manu and then to Raghu. The last point that I want you to focus on is, if a farmer, for example, is going for, say, mustard or some other oil seed, our traditional oil seed, and he has been offered palm oil, okay, from your perspective, is farmer gaining or losing?
So, see, we now, all of us, I think, know this, 86% of farmers are small and marginal farmers, right? And when you start with palm oil, as Arvind said earlier, you have a 5-year waiting period for the first fruits to come. So, 86% of farmers, do we think they can wait for 5 years for the first income to come? So, in this policy, we kind of excluding 86% farmers straight away. आपके लिए ये policy नहीं है, ये mission आपके लिए नहीं है, right? And I don't think so. Forget interest, they are not in a position to even be a part of this mission.
Okay. Right? But and the 14% it can benefit.
It depends. I think the minimum acreage requirement for palm would be something around 1.2 lakh farmers in the country can benefit from it only as of now.
One small point. In the CACP's report, we have identified what he has said, because the opportunity cost of land is so high for a small and marginal farmer. So CACP, in that report which we are referring to, has recommended the government should give a subsidy for the loss of any inflow of funds to the farmer, which he might be foregoing because he is switching over to any other crop.
In the first 5 years.
We have recommended 3 years, because that in the fourth year, but the concept, what you are saying, it's documented in the CACP.
Yes, but sir, it is not part of the policy, not part of the mission. In the mission, there is no such subject.
No, in mission, it's not. But we have identified this cause because we surveyed and we discussed with the farmers.
So I'd like to add on to this. So India has been through an oil deficit earlier. We were having a shortage in 1975. It started 1975, 76, 77. Till 85, 86, we were having 30% imports. And then we have done a technological mission in oil seed, which was headed by a technocrat named Sam Pitroda, whom I think quite a few would know. And from 86 to 91, we doubled the production of traditional oil seeds, and we became self-sufficient, 94%, 95%, 96% self-sufficient from the period 91 to 94 till we signed the WTO. So we were self-sufficient in edible oil till 94-95.
Okay.
Yeah. So we have done this earlier, we can still do this if we get back to that.
Okay. I have to close this session with last point, Raghu. Do you think that for agriculture sector, environment impact assessment should come back, should be started?
Absolutely. Absolutely. There should be not only environment impact assessment, there should also be what is proposed for large-scale
infrastructure projects, road projects, which is a socio-economic assessment also. Because when we talk about ecology, we are not talking only about plants and water and stuff. There is a human ecology to speak of as well. What is happening with small farmers? What's happening with displacement? One of the features that we have observed in the oil palm sector in Andhra and Telangana has been that large farmers have dominated it. They have started buying in land of small farmers who are then displaced from this. Tribal lands have been taken over. You encroach into commons. So there are many socio-economic outcomes of this that also occur, which should be kept in mind. So I fully support what you're saying. There should be environmental impact assessment and socio-economic assessment. And as I said, one of the things which in this mission should be done is look at only those areas where these criteria are met. Environmental impact assessment, social impact assessment, whether you are doing large farmers over there. As you said, the target is very clear. The examples from Andhra, Telangana show that farmers who have between 60 to 100 acres of land are the ones where the maximum uptake of oil palm is, because what they have done is they have kept 50% of their land for other crops. So as a buffer, if something goes wrong here, they've got something to fall back on. Small farmers can't
okay.
do that.
Okay.
So the larger guys, if they've got 40-50% dedicated to this, then if things are working, they can procure.
Okay.
If things are not procured, they can
do. Okay. I'll just open the floor for 5 minutes. Okay. And if there are questions that you want to ask to any of the panelists, please do. Questions, no comments, please. Yeah.
Either it will, it's a community land most of the time. So on community land, whom we are giving? Are we talking of landless farmer there, or farm labor to be engaged there? Who are the people? The definition of farmer itself on the wasteland is disturbing, and it's not very clear here.
I think this issue of what is wasteland that government is talking about is something I don't think any one of us has answered for right now.
My Ministry of Agriculture, this is more than 10 to 12 years ago, they put a number of 6 million hectares. And the problem was, every ministry was saying, we'll do this project in wastelands. So every ministry was eating into it. But there's only 6 million hectares available, number one. And number two, the definition of what is wasteland was very unclear.
Water body is considered wasteland in this country.
See, that's what I'm saying.
Yep.
Even village common lands
yep.
were considered wasteland. Whereas actually it is used for pasture, it is used for
yep.
fodder, it is used for so many things.
Any other question? Yeah, please.
I have a question. I'm a palm oil processor rather than a manufacturer. And I can process any oil, whether it's mustard, palm, soya, whatever. So my question is that one of the panelists mentioned that if other oils are available, you know, why focus on palm oil? Why not focus on other oil? So let's assume that all the demand is met through mustard oil or any other oil. What is the, because I sell to, you know, consumers of palm oil, and what is, there's no guarantee that even if mustard oil or any other oil is available, they are going to use that. End of the day, the demand, or you know, the real demand drives what oil is needed. It's not it's not that if mustard oil is available enough, they will start using mustard oil. They will won't. They will use the cheapest available oil, even if it is the international prices are cheaper than the locally available oil. They will not use that.
Understood. So it is demand and economics which is driving palm oil. Why should you worry?
It's not so.
Okay. It is. I've been in this country for the last 26 years. I know that.
Okay. Anyway, you have asked. I think if you want to reply to that.
So I think it is a fallacy to think that the oil that we eat, we decide. It has been decided for us. And
absolutely, I agree with you. I agree with you.
Yeah. It's fine. Okay.
Sorry.
Okay.
So for example. Pre-independence, you were exporters of edible oil, right? But right now, we can't export mustard to the EU, to the US, to Canada, because they say it is not fit for human consumption. You know that?
That's, we do export mustard oil.
They don't use it for eating.
So mustard is again an example.
So we can have this to and fro later on. Okay.
So I'm saying, sir, basically, it's not just demand and supply. It is the pricing, and the consumers are not aware. And proper marketing by people who really want to promote additional oils, if that happens, its demand can pick off.
Okay.
And if the government tells it properly, then it can pick off.
Okay. You wanted to add something? Quickly, please.
Just quickly responding, I won't contest what you are saying, but I think it depends on the government intention also. If we want to encourage the production of traditional oil seeds and the products based on traditional oil seeds, I think in order to create demand, that's where the government must step in.
Okay.
Instead of withdrawing from there and taking another.
Okay. So let me, okay. Paranjoy can ask, and I see Paranjoy in a different avatar today, completely.
Yeah,
of course. Paranjoy and I go back years, decades.
You know, my panelists are better informed than I. Once upon a time, after crude oil, edible oil was the single biggest item of import in the, if you look at the total import basket. Now, today we don't have a binding foreign exchange constraint. So how desirable it is, you know, how do you balance the interests of the consumer and the interests of the producer of oil seeds? You know, this is a question I'm struggling to find an answer with. I'll be grateful if all the panelists would ask. And I have a second question which is unrelated. When it comes to imports, is it desirable to have a few players dominating the import market? I don't need to name names. Okay. We all know them.
I think you can answer this.
Of course, the foreign exchange is one of the elements, but not the only element which drives the government to think over it. Let us think of the broad, the policy and the philosophy of the government, because we are moving towards the Atmanirbhar, and they, in the crunch situation, we have seen how other players, the international player, have behaved for some political reason not connected to the food economy. Some CAA, they criticize, then we say we will not buy from. So supply bottleneck, you want to protect your own economy. And therefore, that is the driving force that we want to be. Being self-dependent on food item, because you cannot afford to rely too much on the foreign suppliers. I think okay. The supply button.
Paranjay, you can discuss. Let me end this session by thanking all the panelists here. I just want to say that in my previous avatar at Center for Science and Environment in 2008, we did test of all the oil from health perspective. Okay, MUFA, PUFA, amino acids, saturated fat, everything. And we looked at, and what we found was, traditionally Indians never ate one oil. Okay, it was always a mix of oil, because there is no one oil which gives us all the nutrient that we want. No, always. Okay, so the very idea that you see in advertisement today, that this is the best oil and olive is the best and mustard is the best, that has never happened in traditional Indian eating habit. We eat mustard with ghee, or if you go to Western India, we eat groundnut and something else. So we go south, we eat coconut. So I think the health aspect of oil is something that we have not looked at very carefully. And just to answer the question, and I think Manu replied it, we do not decide what we want to eat in today's market. It has already been decided before. Okay? Thank you very much, and let's give a big hand to all the panelists. We will break for tea and then come back for session number 2. Thank you.
And the second session that will follow your keynote address will be on understanding the environmental and health costs of palm oil expansion. So I would request you to give a perspective on behalf of the department, and also if you want to give your personal perspective, we'd be happy to have that too. Sometimes I've seen it varies a lot, so we'd be happy to have both of them. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Mr. Ajay. At the outset, I would like to thank iForest and Bharat Krishak Samaj for inviting me to deliver this keynote address in this stakeholders discussion on betting big on palm oil, risks and opportunities of NMEO OP. It's a privilege for me to address this august gathering. As you all know, Honorable Prime Minister Narendra Modi ji had made this announcement on 9th of August regarding NMEO-OP, and then on 19th of August the cabinet had approved this mission, which is a centrally sponsored scheme. Outlay is 11,040 crores and the 5-year period is from 2021 to 25-26. Now, Mr. Ajay had shared this agenda for today's discussion with me when he visited me last week, Friday you came. So, economics of palm oil you have already discussed, and the environmental and health costs is the next agenda which you are going to discuss. But however, let me tell you that the keynote address I'm going to deliver will not touch upon either the environment or the health cost, because I have to, you know, essentially give the perspective of my department within our jurisdiction. So that is Department of Food and Public Distribution, and also the consumer's interest, which is of prime importance to us. So I'll be touching on various aspects of the edible oil statistics that is available with us, the government figures, so to say, and also I will talk about the domestic and international prices, and also what steps the government is taking, has taken, and is contemplating taking to protect the consumers. So, as you all know, India is the largest consumer of edible oils, and it imports to meet its demand. And the decreasing dependence on imports is perhaps the need of the hour. I'm hopeful that this conference will throw new ideas and enhance the scope of decreasing the import dependency of the country, and also create awareness amongst all stakeholders, which is beneficial to all of us. Now, to get into some of the statistics, I'll just give you. Perhaps it's all known to you, but still I'll repeat it. This is as per the fourth advance estimate released by the Department of Agriculture and Farmers Welfare. So what is the production estimate for 2020-21? It is 361 LMT, while in last year, 2019-20, it was 332 LMT. And how much is the domestic demand for edible oils? It is approximately 250 LMT per year. LMT is lakh metric ton, and otherwise 25 million metric ton. And how much do we produce in India from all sources, primary and secondary? 2020-21, it is estimated at 111.64 LMT. Last year, that is 19-20, it was 107 LMT. Now, around 60% of the edible oil consumed in the country is imported. That is the government figures. I have been seeing some of your figures. You are mentioning 55%. Because we have taken the non-COVID year, where that the COVID effect has not come in. And as per our figures, it is 60%. And also as per this publication, Oil World 2020, India is presently the largest importer of vegetable oils in the world. Now, out of the 60%, lion's share goes to palm oil, 54%, soybean oil, 25%, and sunflower is 19%. So, as you know, domestic production of edible oil is unable to meet the domestic demand, and we have to largely depend on imports. Imports, the duty structure comes in. So, how do we balance the duty structure to protect our farmers, as well as also look at it that the customer gets a price which he can afford? So it's a balancing act between these two. So the Ministry of Agriculture and Farmers Welfare have a different interest. Department of Food and Public Distribution has a different interest. So this has to be balanced. So all these things we dwell upon in the interministerial council meetings, then the committee of secretaries meeting, and then finally the empowered group of ministers who take the informed decision depending upon the suggestions that the government, the committee of secretaries make. So the duty structure is tweaked from time to time based on various inputs that we receive from various stakeholders. Now coming to the consumption habits. This is 2019-20 November to October figures. Palm oil and its derivatives, 30.45%. That is the total share, market share it is having. Soybean is having 21.42%. Mustard, rapeseed oil, 11.63%. Sunflower oil, 10.60%. And groundnut oil is 9%.
And the major consumers of palm oil, all of you will be aware, hotels, restaurants, catering business, fried item producing industry, etc. So need of the hour, increase palm oil production in the country. It will save forex. Secondly, perhaps change the food habits and also ask the farmers not to produce so much of rice and wheat, for which we have overflowing stocks. Stocks are now being diverted for production of ethanol. Instead of producing something which we cannot use, let us have something which will save forex. So that is a higher question, which of course at the highest level it is being deliberated upon. Now, as you know, because we are importing, so the international prices play a very important role in determining the prices in the domestic market. So how has the monthly average retail price moved in the last 1 year? Let me also give you some statistics on this. So this comparison is between September 21 and August 21, and also September 20 and September 21. So the minimum movement was of groundnut oil. It was 20% increase year on year. Month on month increase was 1.40%. Mustard oil is troubling us. On a month-on-month basis, the increase is 3.73%. On a year-on-year basis, it is 41.33%. The highest movement we have seen is soybean oil. On a year-on-year basis, it is 49.14%. So as you see, I mean, to have a holistic view, the prices in the last one and a half year has gone up by 20 to 49%. That is the range. And this is a cause of deep concern to general public as well as the government. And how much is the import bill? I mean, a back of the envelope calculation, if you take average prices, $1,000 per metric ton, exchange rate of 74 rupees per USD, just a back of the envelope calculation, it will come to 111,000 crores, a huge sum of money. So if even 50% of this is saved, that goes a long way in diverting these funds for some other purpose, some other work, say infrastructure development. And to come to some actual figures, these figures have been taken from the ASEAN division of Ministry of Commerce. So in 2021, India imported 73 LMT of crude palm oil. And what is the price we paid? $5.6 billion. That's a huge amount of money. We paid the largest sum to Indonesia, $3 billion, followed by Malaysia, $2.2 billion. And these two countries, they play their game as and when the prices go up, they increase their taxes in the country, and that gets transferred to our domestic consumers. The prices go up, they increase their taxes on the export. So this is something where government has to get into some dialogue with these two major countries, producers from where we take, and have an understanding with them so that we arrive at a agreement which is fair to both of us. Now I'll come to the last part of my discussion. Central government, what are the steps that they are taking to control the situation, at least soften the impact on the domestic prices? Four steps that we have thought about and we are taking also. Import duty rationalization. We have also recently launched a stock disclosure web portal of DFPD. This is in line with the Pulse's disclosure portal launched by DOCA, Department of Consumer Affairs. And also they have, the DOCA has also launched stock limits. Future trading on mustard oil and oilseeds, this was suspended in NCDEX with effect from October 8, very recent. And also subsequently, we have imposed stock limits on both oil seeds and edible oils. This is with effect from October 8. All states and UTs have been informed on 9th of October to take immediate action, and depending on the requirement of the state, they will fix their stock limits. So with the festive season coming in, these are the steps which we think will at least ease the burden of the common consumer. I'll just briefly discuss the duty rationalization part. Budget announcement February 1st, the duty on crude oil, it ranged from 35.75% to 38.5%. This was the duty imposed. Then some changes also came up on 30th June and 19th August 2021. Subsequently, based on discussions in the IMC, Interministerial Council and Committee of Secretaries, the duty was further rationalized on 11th September. Now all crude edible oils carry effective rate of import duty of 24.75% and the refined oils 35.75%. For crude and refined rapeseed oil, purposely it has been kept unchanged at 38.5% and 49.5% with the interest of the mustard growing farmers in the country. This has not been tweaked. Coming back to the agenda of your today's discussion, so I have just given the perspective of my department and a bit of statistics. But I am sure that after discussing on the economic part of it and also keeping in view the health part of it and the environmental impact of palm growth, if some fruitful recommendations emerge at the end of today's discussions, if that could be shared with the government, because government has taken a policy decision and they have gone ahead with this particular project. Now, there is always course for early, mid-term, even end-term course corrections. The earlier the better, because there are quite a few counter forces which are acting against each other. Perhaps the economics would be favorable, but the health part of it and the environment part of it perhaps will be pulling it down. So this August forum has a duty to recommend some fruitful steps for the government, for the policy makers, which will help the government in taking certain steps in correcting, if at all there is something to be done to the policy which is already in place. I think with that, I will be concluding. Thank you so much. Thank you for your patience.
Thank you so much. I think so. If we just take a few questions. Just a few questions. You can avoid whatever you want to avoid. But I just want to
Considering the fact that I'm just not even 1 month old into the sector.
I wanted to say that the sir has just joined this month. So we will, we understand that completely. And I mean, before people ask, you know, being a moderator, one has the mic, so you have a prerogative to say what you want to say. So I have a suggestion, like when you look at the US farm policy, what happens in the US farm policy is if government action leads to loss of income for farmers, then the government compensates farmers. I think that's one crucial component that the government should look at, is that when you change import duties or ban exports and it leads to loss of farmers, then that's one of the steps that fits into many steps that is required to get parity and to get equity into the system. But so any questions, and we'll just take no comments. Any question? Yes, Manuji, please.
So just to understand that, from what I understand from various statistics, the production of edible oil in the country is increasing in the last 2-3 years. So just wanted to understand, why are the prices of edible oil rising if the production is increasing? So there seems to be some sort of a dichotomy in that.
Good question.
Yeah, production is rising, but if you see the consumption pattern, so it is the palm oil and its derivatives. So that is the major market share. It is about 30.45% is that particular share. So and as you import, and for the last 1.5 years, the international prices have really gone up. So because of that, import component goes up, and that has an effect on the domestic prices. And that is the reason we are trying to tweak the duty structure. February, we do something in the budget. Then again, it comes in June, then August, and then again September. We are gradually bringing it down. So we are trying to, you know, counterbalance the international increase in prices. So that duty structure tweaking is one of them. And also mustard production, as you see, the new sowing will come up only from November, and the crop will be available only in March. As on date, our figure says 80% of the crop has already been crushed. So about 20% of the oil seeds, mustard oil seeds, are still left out. Out of that, 2-3% the farmers will retain for the next sowing season, and only a very little amount is left for further crushing and producing. So people are holding back on those stocks, and as a result, as you see, mustard is really bothering us, the way the prices are going up. And it is the eastern part of India and UP also, who consumes a lot of mustard. and the festive season is coming around. So we have taken a drastic step of stock limit order. So that has come out in a late Friday evening order that has been taken out, and on Saturday morning we inform all the states. Then impose stock limits and control the the market. So so these are the steps we have thought about.
Thank you for your presentation. A quick question on, since you come from Department of Food, and I just wanted to ask, when you say palm oil being a concern, whereas when you talk about food basket, it includes multiple items. Now, promotion of one kind of oil and a crop, don't you think that it will have a significant impact upon the kind of food basket India has been talking about, or the diversity of food grains items which we had earlier? It may have an impact on, for example, pulses, millets, which are already facing a problem in terms of production and increasing prices. So what would you say to that? Thank you.
Perhaps the question is more appropriate for Agriculture Secretary to answer. Perhaps for Agriculture Secretary to answer, not our domain, but still I will answer it from the economics point of view. Since we bring in so much of palm oil from Indonesia, Malaysia, and I said in 2021 the bill was $5.6 billion. So make it, even if we can make it 50%, then we don't have to go for asset monetization. Presently the government has declared asset monetization. We don't need to go for asset monetization. Save 50% of that money, put it, pump it back into infrastructure. So that is my thought process. I think agriculture will be in a better position to answer.
To add on to the earlier question, so like there's a sort of a shortage of mustard oil going on, and we are promoting palm oil. So do we see that in the future we're kind of trying to convert the mustard oil demand to palm oil demand?
Perhaps no, because my immediate reaction to that question will be no, because food habits of people don't change overnight. And this scheme is for a 5-year period, 21, 22 to 25, 26. And only 11,000 crores will be pumped in. So it has to be a larger long-run process to have a balance between mustard consumption and domestic production increase of palm oil. So that is a higher policy question which immediately cannot be answered in this forum. And I don't see in the immediate future that our demand for mustard will go down. Rather it will stay. The other way around is to encourage people to consume the poor cousin of that, which is your rapeseed oil. So if the rapeseed oil consumption goes up, then mustard oil consumption may come down depending on the food habits and preferences of the people. That's how I look at it.
So, for example, if we are now going towards palm, so palm would take 5 years as a crop to come, because that's gestation period. So till then, do we see inflation in mustard oil prices for the next 5 years?
Difficult to say, but as I said, government has taken 4-5 steps. So, and we have also requested the Agriculture Department to promote more of mustard growth, which may come up in the next season. So with all the steps coming in, we don't anticipate again a meteoric rise in the prices. Perhaps it will be controlled. And maybe in the next year, next financial year, next oil year, you will see a stable price or even a decreasing price.
Thank you. Thank you so much. Before we wind up and we let you go, I just want to say, from a farmers organization point of view, I think the agriculture research system has let Indian farmers and Indian government down, and that's why yields of traditional oil seeds have not risen to world levels, or they were very, very, very far behind. But having said that, I think so Ministry of Food could also look at, talk to the finance ministry and others to impose tax on unhealthy foods, ultra processed foods, over saturated foods, oil use. I think so that will help drive consumption habit change, as very you clearly said. Thank you so much for your time. Thank you for coming and joining us. And we'll, whatever comes out of the we will share with you.
Yeah, you must share with us, because that helps us in taking policy interventions. I will take it forward to our interministerial council meetings.
Yes.
Anything meaningful can be discussed over there.
Thank you so much. Thank you for your time.
Thank you. Thank you.
So, thank you. Thank you so much. We'll move on to the next panel discussion, which is on understanding the environment and health costs of palm oil expansion. The discussion note has already been shared with everyone. And I think we will go in a random order, so we don't have a structure which I think so gets the best out of a panel. So I will start with you because you're closest to me. I'll request you to give a few points, and then we'll spend more time in questioning and debating the subject.
I think morning, everyone. I'm also here on behalf of Dakshin Foundation. I should have mentioned that earlier. I think the morning session, Shubha J.S. ma'am, very clearly has said that, you know, one should not really be concerned about the environment because, you know, it's not on forest land, there's not going to be any deforestation, it's not going to be a monocrop, you know, plus they are kind of making kind of arrangements or whatever mechanisms to ensure drip irrigation, vermicomposting and all that. I think that's really welcome because no one is saying that don't grow the palm oil, but one is also talking about, you know, where it should be done. I think the fact that the focus is on Northeast and the Andamans, I think that is something. Both of them are very ecologically rich and fragile areas, so there has to be a very precautionary approach there on water. And plus the fact that I would say that, you know, it's good to know that, I think Raghu's also, you know, raised that yes, there will be drip irrigation, but where is that water going to come from? And just because it's Northeast, there are dry months in Northeast also, you know. So, I mean, it's not that just because it's a high rainfall area that you really don't need any irrigation system. I think that's one thing. Second, I think 60% of Arunachal is actually unclassed forest. That's with communities. So, what is considered, you know, forest and non-forest also, there is sometimes a thin line there. Similarly, the whole wasteland, I think enough has been discussed. We are not very clear about what has been discussed there. The fact is that I believe in islands, especially in Andamans, where there's Kachal or Baratang and others, those are also inhabited by tribes, which are, you know, all little Andamans. And there are grasslands there, at least Kachal and other areas. So are grasslands being looked at as wastelands? And there is a very clear interdependence, interlinkages of tribes and the, you know, ecosystems there. So I think that's something which I just wanted to flag, because like we're not very sure what does that the wasteland mean. And I think just because there is no forest land involved, there may be other biodiversity impacts also. I think I'll just like to flag some of these points and just let it be here right now. Thanks.
So, Dr. Santosh, can we move on?
Well, I think lots has been discussed this morning. I, being a nutritionist, I would like to first highlight that we need a combination of saturated fatty acids, monounsaturated fatty acids, and polyunsaturated fatty acids in a ratio of 1:1:1. So thinking that SFA is bad for our health is absolutely a myth, I would say. And as regards palm oil is concerned, its saturated fatty acid content is around 46%, and it has around 42% of monounsaturated fatty acids or so. The saturated fatty acid is palmitic acid, which is C16, not that bad. And the monounsaturated fatty acid, which I said is around 43% to 44%, is oleic acid. And one of the good points is that oleic acid is attached on the carbon 2 of the glyceride molecule, which is good for health. Of course, the unsaturated fatty acid among monounsaturated fatty acid and polyunsaturated fatty acid. So the polyunsaturated fatty acid component of palm oil is low, that is 10%. So the point is that we cannot get everything from only one oil. The first point I, as a nutritionist, want to say that we need to have combinations of oils in our diet. As we look back into it, traditionally, we used to use pure ghee, mustard oil, which was a common oil consumed in the north. South, of course, we have coconut oil. Now, what is the saturated fatty acid content of coconut oil? Is around 90%, 89% is saturated fatty acid, and yet coconut oil is not bad. How about pure ghee? Pure ghee has around 70% of saturated fatty acids. Other oils like groundnut oil, etc., they have around 20%, thin oil, etc., have 10%. So I would just like to say that majority of the oils, the edible oils, have 10 to 20% saturated fatty acids, and these are the oils which contain more of polyunsaturated fatty acids, the PUFA. PUFA content of these groundnut oil, thin oil and all is somewhere around 60 to 70% or 15% or so. What we talked of in the morning, sunflower oil or curry oil, I have been in the field of nutrition, I have been teaching since 1970, so I can go back to my college days, and soon after that, curry oil or sunflower oil was the choicest oil for good health and all heart health. But over a period we realized this is only rich in omega-6 fatty acids, and we need a combination of omega-3 and omega-6 fatty acids, the two essential fatty acids series in our diet. Human race developed on a diet containing 1:1 of omega-3 to omega-6. Our need is 1 part of omega-3 to 5 to 10 parts of omega-6. And our diet contains large amount of omega-6, which is not very good for health. And it is presently somewhere around 1 part of omega-3 to 25 to 30 parts of omega-6. Unfortunately, the sunflower oil contains 68 to 70% of omega-6, and that became bad for health. So we need to balance it, and for balancing, I would always say that we should have a proper combination of the oils. I did one work in 1970s, and this is the recipe book. This was brought out to promote the red palm oil, because red palm oil not only provides energy, or the PUFA, which is very good for health, but it also provides large amounts of beta-carotene and the vitamin E in two forms, tocopherol and tocotrienol. The beta-carotene content can vary between 500 to 700 parts ppm.
And the vitamin E, tocopherols and tocotrienols can be somewhere around 600 to 1000 ppm in this. Among the tocopherol and tocotrienols, trienol being a little more unsaturated, it's a much potent antioxidant. So in other words, among the oils, I would say red palm oil. I'm not talking of the refined palm oil at the moment. I'll come to that also. Red palm oil is a very, very rich source of beta-carotene and tocotrienols and tocopherols, which are natural nutrient antioxidants, and these help in promoting our heart health. They prevent all the NCDs, cancers, etc. Even they help in aging, they are anti-aging. Antioxidants are anti-aging, and arthritis, etc., etc. So there is no adverse health effect of palm oil unless it is taken in very large quantities. That can probably cause some liver problems. Now, when I was working on red palm oil, which is physically refined oil. Now, here I want to define the physically refined and cold pressed oils versus the other oils. We have already talked of the solvent extraction of oils, which we know it's wrong. When we are refining by heat process, during that odor, flavor, color are of course removed. But another thing which is generated is the trans fatty acid content. I have been into the field of research on trans fats for the last 15 to 20 years, and trans fat is the one which is bad for our health. And trans fat, all of us know, it can be generated only in three ways. One is through hydrogenation process. Second, small amount of ruminant trans fat comes from the natural foods, which are from milk and milk products and all. That's not that bad. And secondly is when the oils are subjected to heat, whether it is during the process of refining, high temperatures like 200 to 250 degrees centigrade, they generate a lot of trans fat. And trans fat has already raised the point. Everybody wants to say that yes, food should be low in zero in trans fat. Another process is frying and baking where trans fats are produced during, because it's a heat, it's a cis conversion to trans, which is an isomeric conversion, and that takes place at high temperatures. Now coming to this our palm oil, and again I will emphasize more on red palm oil. Red palm oil, since it contains around 46% of saturates, SFA, it is little solid at almost room temperature, depending upon what is the temperature. And we need solid fats, or more like plastic fats, I would use the word, not solid, it's plastic. We need plastic fats for bakery items, and that is the reason how hydrogenated fat came into our use. Now, since we want to have a natural replacement for hydrogenated fats, so the zero in trans fat, palm oil, which is zero in trans fat, is a very good replacement for the hydrogenated fat. So I would recommend that we should go in for fractional separation, fractionization of our oils. Maybe when we need for bakery, we can use the red palm oil as a plastic fat. But at the same time, as I mentioned, that there is a very strong odor and flavor of palm oil is not acceptable to all of us. So this was a research project by ICAR funded one, where I tried to see how can we improve the consumer acceptability of the oil. And the best way is to dilute its odor by mixing it with other vegetable oils. I had taken mixed vegetable oil, and I found that savory items, because of the we can tolerate a little higher amount of fat. So savory items and the food items with lower amount of total fat, we can use one part red palm oil and one part other vegetable oil, whichever we want to take it. And when it is a sweet item, like halwas and all, there could be about one part red palm oil to 3 to 4 parts of the other oil. And I have about 100 recipes where I sort of, found out not only the laboratory acceptability trials, not only the mass acceptability, because in the programs, if we give the food, which is being given free, everybody will take it. But I conducted the sale trials also, and the food cooked in red palm oil was highly acceptable at all levels. There was one more research, just one second. There was one more research study where I baked the biscuits. It was a PhD work of my student, where biscuits prepared in red palm oil were fed to the school children. That was a different concept, but we were working on the beta carotene component. And I just want to highlight that biscuits made using red palm oil plus other vegetable oil were given to the children for continuously for 2 months, and that was acceptable. So we can improve the acceptability of red palm oil by mixing it. I'm not using the word blending, because it's called mixing by Food Safety Authority, with other edible oils. And I think that should be able to sort of, take care of our oil needs. Thank you.
Thank you. So you mentioned Food Safety Authority. Ashish Bahugunaji was at Food Safety Authority 3 years ago, but we'll come to you at the end, because...
Don't blame me for everything.
So we will come to some of the things later. So Dr. Prasenjit Biswas, can we have your points, please? Thank you so much. And we'll once we finish quickly, then we'll have time for comments again by the panelists.
Dear Chairman, sir, and also iForest, thanks for inviting me, especially for a Northeastern perspective. This oil palm plantation in the case of Northeast actually resembles the global experience that Tania Murray Lee, one of the very important social anthropologists at University of Toronto, has written this new book called Plantation Lives, How Corporates Have Invaded Indonesian Palm Fields. That book substantially establishes that the plantation cultivation in Indonesia only creates emissarization, marginalization of the outgrowers, and the land is taken over by the corporate in a legitimate manner by organizing several types of predisposed violences, which he calls as a process of desubjectivation of the palm oil farmers, and which she explains in so many ways with so many examples. She calls it a kind of a perpetuation of predatory values, whereby land is stolen, labor is stolen, and the fruits of palm oil cultivation are accumulated in the form of primitive accumulation, are taking away the sources of funding, capital, labor, and every other resources for production away from the small farmers. Now, there is a set of middle-level farmers whom she calls as outgrowers. These outgrowers have to immediately transfer the palm oil fruit to a processing unit within 48 hours. And because they cannot transfer it so soon, within 48 hours, many of these middle-level farmers become victim of some other kind of contracts and corporate middlemen who literally take over fields, land, and the product, and these outgrowers are not able to sustain themselves. So therefore, Tania Morelli quotes anthropologist George Backford's concept of persistent poverty in the case of Indonesia and Malaysia. Now, this is the global context. In what ways this global experience is going to be different in case of rekindling of an excessive sense of entitlement that is currently propagated by the Union government? It's highly exceptional to think about that these disruptive and wrenching experiences that are coming from elsewhere will not reproduce themselves in the context of India, and especially in the context of Northeast. Now, in the context of Northeast, the greatest concern is the latest proposed amendments in the Forest Rights Act of in the National Forest Act of 1980, where non-forest purposes can be used for encroaching forest land. And that is something which is going to endanger much of the traditional forest lands in the case of Northeast. Let's take the example of Arunachal Pradesh. Forest lands that are grown by Adis and Apatanis and Nishis intergenerationally is now dwindling to the level of 33% and less than the national river average in their own habitats in certain districts of Arunachal Pradesh. Now, these areas have become fallow land, and this fallow land is not utilized for shifting cultivation or for any other purposes. Now, if palm oil is grown there, what kind of benefit is going to reap is not at all for the community. It is rather a benefit which will transfer the entire benefit outside the state of Arunachal Pradesh. In case of Meghalaya, the situation would be even more severe and dangerous, because Meghalaya has two kinds of forest lands. Lau Kintang, that's sacred grove, and also another kind of traditionally raised forest land called Lau Lindo. Now, between Lau Kintang and Lau Lindo, where will there be wasteland, and where will there be a chance of growing oil palm? So therefore, the large subtropical moist broadleaf forest that Meghalaya has is going to face a certain kind of an onslaught because of the replacement of these forests by palm oil. I will end by referring to one important argument that came from morning speaker, is substitution of rice cultivation, which is going to be a complete disaster in the case of Northeast India, because much of the Northeastern communities depend on terrace cultivation, and they cultivate rice as the main crop. Now, in terrace cultivation areas, how could there be palm cultivation? Then the other important point of concern is the state of hydrosphere in Brahmaputra Valley, in Barak Valley, and also in some of the hilly regions. It could be easily seen how this hydrosphere is depleting itself, And with oil palm cultivation, it will further be depleted because there will be a kind of desertification of the hydrosphere. And this will create a grave water crisis, which is currently not there in the case of Northeast India. So these are the major concerns that I wanted to flag. And to sum it up, I would say that it will be all the big companies who will slowly enter into the small plots of land, and they will lease out this land or they will lease off this land. And that's going to be a kind of a transition from the small and outgrowers to the big companies in next 10 years time or so. So that's the gravest possibility that is arising if we take what Tania Murali had seriously written about Indonesia and Malaysia. That's it. Thank you.
Thank you so much for your clear articulation. And I think so the Contract Farming Act helps what you're propagating or what you're indicating to. We'll move on to Madhuri Nanda, please. Thank you for joining us. And I think so Rainforest Alliance will have a interesting perspective on the issue of, yes, I think so.
First up, I have to really thank the organizers for this very insightful, useful discussion and dialogue. And I really hope that, you know, something from this discussion really goes back to the government, because I think that's very important. I see a lot of lack of clarity, I would say, on a lot of issues that have come up in terms of what exactly is government proposing. And we need more discussions and deliberations to get that better clarity. If we are talking about degraded land, what are we really talking about? What are the expansion areas are we talking about? I would like to take more of, when we're talking about risk and opportunities, I would like to take more opinion on the opportunity side, just to bring the balance to the forum here. Now, I'm representing here, I'm from Rainforest Alliance. We are a non-profit entity, work in more than 70 countries. And in India, we are working more, we are into sustainable agriculture promotion through certification and landscape level initiatives. We work with farmers and forest communities, so we have a lot of experience there. I'm representing here Sustainable Palm Oil Coalition of India, ISPOC, we call it for short, which for last 3 years has been working on palm oil production in India, not just production, but also looking at trade. So we are here trying to, it's the founding members include WWF, we have RSPO, Rainforest Alliance, and Center for Responsible Business, which is managing the secretariat of the ISPOC. We've had for last 3 years it's a multi-stakeholder platform. We have research units, we have, in addition to researchers and the experts, also businesses who are a part of this platform, who have commitment towards sustainability, and we see a ray of hope there. So we are trying to see how these companies can actually look at sustainable journeys within themselves, starting with the sustainability policies, trying to go towards certification. And there are different other opportunities also in terms of disclosures and transparency that can be brought in palm oil production and trade, which is what we are trying to look at. Of course, the risk factors which have been discussed since morning are important to consider, but we also think that it is possible that we could take the sustainability route of growing palm and still reap the benefit for improving the livelihoods of the farmers there. I would not, in the previous session, we were talking about excluding the small farmers completely because of the 5 years time gestation period. I would say if there are possibilities of getting diverse crops in the beginning of those 5 years and then looking at it in a holistic view, I would still give it a try. In Indonesia, from our experiences, what we have seen, just to quickly mention that a lot of small farmers have been into oil palm production and they have basically led to the deforestation, because it's more easier to control and look at and monitor the larger companies. But working with the small farmers has been the biggest challenge in Indonesia that we have seen. So I would like to probably conclude with this point that as ISPOC, as a coalition, we are trying to really see how we can handhold the existing policy environment and look at the small farmers through our member WWF, we are also looking at the existing policy regimes and trying to see how we can work for the benefit of all. So I still see opportunities there if we can go in this direction for palm production. Yeah, thank you.
Thank you so much. And so we come to the last panelist, who I have been very fortunate to receive his advice through the years. And like he said, he can't blame everything at food safety authority is not responsible for it, but I can say he's a lot responsible for all my mistakes. So Yunachi, the floor is yours.
Thank you, Ajayji. Yes, it's been my fortune, or maybe misfortune, of having worked in the government for 40 years, so and a lot of it in the Ministry of Agriculture. So a lot of the ills that plague the sector can possibly be attributed to me. But just a few quick points, you know. I think, first of all, I think we are trying to make, you know, much ado about what will really turn out to be nothing. You know, government, especially, well, certainly government of India, but also in the states, things tend to come around in a full circle. So the palm oil thrust has been imparted in the past, and it has kind of exhausted itself, and all these, you know, the areas, the focus areas of the mission, the Northeast, the islands, and all that has been dealt with in the past and tried, and the government has failed fairly spectacularly, and but all of us tend to have short memories, so here we are again. So that is there. One quick point, I mean, I think, of course, the caveat is that a lot of my information is dated, so probably it would need to be, you know, checked and confirmed and things. First of all, as far as oilseeds is concerned, and maybe Dr. Pasi can help me here, as far as our pure health and nutritional needs are concerned, we produce enough. You know, what we are actually consuming is far more than we need. That is one. So just saying that, you know, whether it's good or bad or indifferent or whatever, that is one thing. We have to change lifestyles. You know, it's all very well talking about the good effects and the bad effects and the adverse effects and so on and so forth. That's not likely to happen. Because I think in the morning session you were asking why prices are still going up, because consumption is increasing so rapidly. That, you know, production is unable to keep pace. And it is a fact that out of all the oil seeds, palm oil has the highest productivity. It is a fact. Now, whether oil palm productivity in India will be as good as the oil palm productivity in Southeast Asia, I would doubt very much. You know, the agroclimatic conditions in India are not at all suitable, not even in the Northeast. In the Northeast, incidentally, because IMD, you know, when they look at weather data, they're looking at 50-year and 100-year averages. But I know for certain, for the past 30 years, that in the Northeast, rainfall has been consistently about 20% below normal. So what we attribute to the Northeast, the rainfall, is much lower than what it actually is. One, and like you had pointed out, I mean, rainfall is not uniform around the year, unlike in the equatorial countries. So we have to remember that palm oil is native to Africa and equatorial Africa. And those kind of, you know, the conditions conducive to oil palm growth probably may not exist in India, may not be easily replicated in India. Having said that, of course you can grow palm. If you provide the appropriate amount of irrigation, you can certainly do it. But whether you need to do it or not is a call that you have to take as a policy maker. We had earlier suggested that instead of trying to, produce palm oil inefficiently in the country, it may be better to import it, like Paranjoy had asked in the morning. It makes a lot of economic sense to import cheap oil if it's more cheaply produced abroad. I mean, and if markets were perfect, that is exactly the way we would have liked to go. But and at that time, to protect the domestic industry, unfortunately, Mr. Das is gone. And he was talking about, you know, reviewing the duty structure every 3 months and so on and so forth. We had proposed a counter-cyclical duty structure, which government, for whatever reasons, did not accept. Because otherwise, that would have consistently protected the interests of the farmers, kept a kind of a, you know, stability in prices, so that when prices in Indonesia and Malaysia went up, duties would go down. When prices in Malaysia and Indonesia went down, our duties would go up, and the consumers would more or less get their products at the same time. So, but that didn't happen for whatever reason. I'm not very sure whether this focus on, let's take the islands first, because there used to be, there was an order of the Supreme Court in probably in the 90s or 2000s, okay, you know, which, because there was an attempt made at that time also for promotion of oil palm, and the Andaman seemed the right place, you know, close to Indonesia, more or less the same climatic conditions and so on and so forth. But some activists had taken the matter to the court, and at that time the Supreme Court had made a decision. Now, of course, a lot of water has flown down the Jamuna since then, and I'm really not very sure whether the Supreme Court has allowed this, or has it just kept silent. I'm not quite sure, but I think that needs a little bit of investigation, because tampering with the ecology of the islands is fraught with danger. And I mean, besides, you know, the lifestyle of the tribals and the very fragile ecosystem there, it's fraught with danger. There are areas in the northeast where oil palm cultivation has been going on for more than 15 years. For instance, Binsuram. Has it been successful? I don't think so. I mean, like I said, my information is a bit dated, so it probably needs to be looked at, you know, by the. And at that time, I mean, firstly, the topography is difficult, like Mr. Biswas pointed out. So, you know, the cultivation and easy harvesting is difficult. You need mechanical harvesting for oil palm, because they grow to be slightly unwieldy in size once they, you know, age. So you need mechanical harvesting, which is probably not possible in a, you know, in an undulating terrain. And plus, you need the processing center to be close by, so that the fruit can be delivered to the processing center within 48 hours, and in fact the sooner the better, because that also, there's a loss of productivity the longer you delay it. So that hasn't worked as yet. So to expect that it'll work because government has made a mission is, well, all right. Good luck. But having said that, I mean, I, of course, Dr. Pasi gave a very elaborate, presentation on the benefits and whatever. Palm oil. Palm oil has a very long shelf life. You know, that is, you know, besides being inexpensive, the least expensive of the oils, which is actually, money makes the world go round. So obviously, I mean, and all this talk about consumers having, consumer is bothered, ki bhai sasta jitne mein de do. A consumer is not you and I. Consumer is an ordinary person who's striving to make two ends meet. So sabse sasta jo hai wo leta hai, wo khula leta hai. Wo packaged product nahi leta hai. All in the morning they were talking about safflower and this and that. वो नहीं लेता है भाई, उसकी he doesn't have that kind of purchasing power. So it has a long shelf life, it withstands high temperature, so it's very good for frying, and in India, of course, all the industrial products that are fried use palm oil. And the problem in India is, as Dr. Pasi pointed out, that what happens is that because it withstands high temperature, but if you reheat it, then the cholesterol problem starts worsening. So otherwise it's trans fat free,
but you keep reheating and you know, you create
no problems.
You have high saturated fat. Otherwise,
it's very good. It has antioxidants, vitamin E, helps absorb vitamin A, lots of good points. But like she said, we need a combination of oils, and that is, you know, a dietary diversity in the basket. Now, whether that can be forced by the government is something I don't think that's possible. You can give a choice to the consumers, but at the end of the day, and especially when you know, living is such a challenge, consumers tend to buy the cheapest products or the most easily available products. So it is there. So you know, I don't think that, you know, you can wish away oil palm. What you can do certainly is to try and raise the productivity of other edible oils, and there's a dietary preference for that, of taste and availability and, you know, traditions. So that, of course, you can certainly try and do that, but that is a long haul. So overnight miracles are not likely to happen. As far as, you know, and also let me tell you, one more thing is that the loser that our regulatory regimes are, the more will be the proliferation of palm oil in addition and mixing and whatever, blending, whatever you call it, to cheaper oils. And wherever oils are sold in loose, unpackaged forms, palm oil will be there. So I agree, I think, with Ms. Nanda. We have to try and see how we can make best possible use of a necessary evil, and try and see what regulations can be put in place, what are the practical regulations that can be put in place. Because as far as the farmers are concerned, am I taking too long?
No.
As far as the farmers are concerned, you're right. The small farmers can only take up this if they are aggregated, and they are, you know, and their produce is tied up with a processing house, which is how the earlier oil palm missions used to work, which were funded under the Rashtriya Krishi Vikas Yojana. Now this mission probably is being funded separately, but that doesn't really make a difference. So possibly the scheme that will come to answer your question would be the same as the earlier scheme under the Rashtriya Krishi Vikas Yojana, where for the first 3 years there's a lot of monetary subsidy given to the oil palm farmers to compensate for their loss of income. And there was mixed plantations, you know, vegetables and short duration crops at that time, so as to help them tide over the initial problem. But then again, that is easier said than done, because if you try to promote vegetable cultivation, for instance, in Mizoram, where will the poachers go and sell those vegetables? No, you can grow something, but you have to have everything put in place. That's why it's not such an easy thing. That's why I think we are making a lot of unnecessary noise about this. This is not likely to go very far. There will be a few isolated cases of success, and more power to them, because the country needs oil, and the country needs oil at as low cost as possible. But one possible way of doing it to ensure that we have consistency in policy. Now we have this stockholding unit, you have, you know, a ban in futures trading, so on and so forth. Wherever farmers get a chance of making some money, government is very quick to pounce upon, you know, and frame all the regulatory obstacles in the way. Everything in this country or anywhere in the world is actually consumer-centric. It's the consumers that rule, and as long as that is there, so be it. So thank you.
Thank you. Bhagunaji, thank you so much. Actually, when we designed the panel, we'd hope that you defend the government to the nail, but it just so happens we messed up the way we designed it, but nevertheless. So I think so we'll just go first, we'll give each panelist a time to respond to what they have heard, and then we will take questions, which will give more time to the panelists to respond. So if every panelist takes 2 minutes to give their inputs. And Ma'am Opal, we'll begin with you. Thank you so much.
I think, yeah, just to take it forward from what Bhavanaji said, that the fact is that if it is going to happen, then we need to also look at, you know, what has really failed in the past, or why is Mizoram not working. You know, Carrie had done a lot of studies on the Little Andamans thing, so what were the lessons learned from that? Because, and also the fact that, you know, like the whatever I recall of that 80s research work was that there was decrease in soil fertility, and there was, you know, also increase in pests, I think rodents substantially. So looking at all of that factor, plus, you know, earlier in the morning there was this whole thing was that there will be new technology, we are going to put a lot of inputs. I think if there's more clarity on what that happens, so the whole crux is that if it's happening somewhere where it's not, you know, where you don't have really great biodiversity impacts, then how are you going to make it more sustainable? And for that, I think you have to really look at what you've done in the past and what has really, you know, worked and what has not worked and why that has not worked. I think we need much more studies if we have to, you know, wherever we do it. And of course, you know, islands are very fragile, you know, and it's a very interconnected ecosystems. You know, there are littoral forests, there are mangroves, there are seagrasses, all within 50, 500, 100 meters of each other. So I don't really know how you're going to go up. Similarly, you know, northeast is also, and the fact is if that Jhum area is going to be considered as wasteland or agriculture land, that is all on slope. So, you know, are you going to level that those areas? So, I mean, these are also some things which has to be, you know, looked at, because leveling something is going to really have, you know, another other kind of repercussions, you know. And any area which is a monoculture compared to anything, a mixed cropping or rotation cropping, definitely has more, that area has more biodiversity than that. But these are all pros and cons. I mean, if it is something, yes, we understand that we need more oil because, you know, we as a, as a country, we need it. But where it's going to happen, what are the lessons which we've learned, and how do we ensure that we actually, you know, don't repeat our mistakes? I think I would kind of end here.
We'll come back.
Thanks.
Firstly, I would just like to comment that palm oil helps in the production of it helps in the production of prostacyclins in the body, which prevent thrombosis, and it lowers the production of thrombaxins, which increase thrombosis. Thrombosis is clot formation. So it is both ways. It prevents clot formation, and that way it helps in preventing all our cardiovascular diseases, and also from that angle it is better suited. Second point, what we were talking of, the trans fatty acid formation. Trans fat is really bad to health. But the point is that in case of palm oil, we have nearly 46% saturated fatty acids. When it is saturated, it cannot be converted into trans fat. Another 45-46% is monounsaturated MUFA, where the oleic acid, the monounsaturated fatty acid, is in the middle carbon. So it's again not so much affected by heat to form the trans fat. And only around 10% is the polyunsaturated fatty acid. So when trans fat, palm oil is used for baking or frying, TFA formation is far lower as compared to other oils which contain polyunsaturated fatty acids.
Are you referring to red palm oil?
No, it's both ways. Red palm oil has an added advantage because of its high antioxidant properties. Both beta-carotene and tocotrienols and tocopherols, they also prevent oxidation because they are antioxidants. So, from both angles, but I am more pro to red palm oil. From two angles, I am a nutritionist. Vitamin A deficiency is highly prevalent in our country. On one side, we are fortifying milk and other foods with vitamin A, and on the other hand side, we are trying to remove the beta-carotene which is present in it. And beta-carotene has two functions, not only as a pro-vitamin, but as a strong nutrient antioxidant. Another point which I want to say is that there is no point in just raising the production of palm oil unless we create the demand. So actually this work of mine had created the demand. I must say there was a lot of demand for it. All those who had been involved in the training and production of these food items, they wanted red palm oil, and I had no source to provide them because I had just got it for my own researches. So I would say there should be a simultaneous work on creating demand for the product as well as supply. And for this first item, first step, what we can do is, we have many of our nutrition related programs, midday meal program, ICDS, and public distribution system. So we can first put in, create awareness among the people about the positive aspects of palm oil, include red palm oil, I'm again emphasizing more on red palm oil than the other one, in the food items being distributed through these systems. And again, I reiterate that we should not only and only provide red palm oil because of its acceptability may not affect the intake of the food items. So we should mix it with other vegetable oils which are consumed in the area.
Farming in Northeast India is rather it's rather community based, and therefore farming is in the hands of the community. So what it would do is a kind of a change of social arrangement. The communities which are farming dependent will now have to depend on a set of middlemen if palm oil at all materializes. Of course, that's a difficult proposition that it won't materialize for the undulating hills. And in the plain areas, the rice fields and the owners of the rice fields are not going to hand it over for palm oil production, even if there are allurements. So therefore, a kind of a political economy tension will be created by this project of palm oil expansion in Northeast. And then it will be in conflict with other kinds of plantations as well, because there's a lot of tea plantation in Northeast which are very profitable even now. So tea producing areas cannot be now converted into suddenly oil palm producing areas. That cannot happen. Now, as far as wasteland in Northeast is concerned, it is already said large part of the wasteland in Northeast India is wetland, basically. And all kinds of wetlands. Some are Ramsar kind of wetland. Some are wetlands that are not attended to at all. Now, these wetlands provide the moisture supply in the air, based on which you have this forestry. Part of it is rainforest, part of it is deciduous, part of it is subtropical, and also it provides the necessary succulent for all other kinds of cropping pattern that you have in Northeast. Now the biggest danger will be the depletion of this water cycle and the food security that currently Northeast has. The moment somebody goes from Delhi and says we want to replace rice production, Mizoram is not a highly rice producing area. So there can be some experiments in Mizoram at the cost of some of these crops that Mizos are cultivating, but not in Meghalaya, Nagaland, Arunachal Pradesh, Assam, Manipur and Tripura. So therefore, you know, it becomes practically defeated because large part of Northeast will not be responding positively to that kind of an idea. Now, searching out the wasteland and turning forest lands into non-forest uses, which this Forest Amendment Act is going to facilitate, and coming of the corporates in a large way in the land grab kind of a situation, which is happening in Assam, a large number of farmers, peasants, they are evicted from Assam, from variety of land near Kaziranga, in Sipajhar and all these areas. Now these lands will be grabbed by a set of corporate. The land grabbing process has already started. Ramdev has got land in Chirang district, in Baksa district, which are agricultural land and also forest land. So therefore, there's a cycle of land grab that's going to happen in Assam and is going to spill over onto the Imphal Valley, also in Tripura. So in the plain areas, a land grab circuit is going to operate through this palm oil project. So therefore, these are some of the cautionary pre-thinking that one should do in the context of Northeast. Apart from major impact in the fragile ecosystem, the cloud forming areas are going to lose the moisture that is absolutely needed for the maintaining the ecosystem balance and also maintaining the optimal level of rainfall in Northeast. Rain is going to be majorly affected by this kind of palm oil cultivation. So these are some of the very, very alarming pictures which made palm oil cultivation absolutely unpopular. Agatha Sangma, MP from Tura and a prominent face of Northeast, has written a strong letter rejecting the idea of palm oil. Yesterday I was traveling with Mr. Badruddin Ajmal, who otherwise does cash cropping. So when I explained to him that oil palm is going to bring disaster, he said, we are going to lobby so that oil palm cultivation doesn't happen in Northeast. So that's it, I think, for now.
Thank you so much. Professor Biswas, not much happens with lobbying, with especially
against the MPs more up. They are going to lobby.
Yes, I hope somebody listens to them. But we'll move on to the next, ma'am. It's
absolutely. And that's the reason why maybe it's important to keep the cautionary note as well as look at the opportunities that could so as long as we are looking at the caution and still keeping the sustainability mode, I'll just come back to that again, because just to give a small comment on the point that the tea estates in Northeast are profitable, I think I would beg to differ on that. We have Rainforest Alliance has a lot of tea members who are certified by Rainforest Alliance. They are in Assam. Beginning of last month, I think 11 of the big certificate holders, we had personal one-to-one meetings with their CEOs and MDs, and they all are grappling with the decreasing prices, increasing cost of production, climate change, everything that is devastating all the sectors, but tea and coffee plantations, as we see, as we talk to the members, they are really facing a challenge. So they do look for crop diversification. And in one of those meetings, one of the MDs were actually talking to me that we have some open land which is available. Do you think we should grow palm on those lands? So they are open to it. So that's why I say that if there is a policy decision, there is lack of clarity exactly what areas are we talking about. So if those areas could be areas like these, where there is a potential, then there is no harm. That money which is coming from the government could actually be used for building infrastructure, could be used for helping the interest of the small farmers. So if there is a shift towards exploring those opportunities and bringing more sustainability agenda on those communications which are coming from the policy side, that could really be useful for the country as a whole. Another thing which I just wanted to quickly mention is about what was mentioned earlier is the predatory nature of companies. I think I would say working with a lot of companies, we are seeing a general shift towards sustainability as well. They want to understand how do they make their production more sustainable? How do they make their sourcing more sustainable? They are making those global commitments. And we as an organization, Rainforest Alliance, and as a coalition, as ISPOC, we are trying to help them through this sustainability journey. So if I think we could make those companies realize how they could ensure the environment and social parameters are kept in place while the palm production is happening, if the government is ready to take those kind of initiatives, keeping in mind, and these policies are created, keeping in mind the sustainability aspects, and if the small farmers' interests are still kept in place, then I think there is still a potential way forward where it could be taken as a good opportunity forward. Thank you.
So I think so. We'll take questions and then everybody gets time to. Yes, Manuji, please. Just take a mic. Take a mic. We need your loud voice to be heard, you know.
So just to check with Dr. Pasi. So, ma'am, are you saying palm oil is healthier than mustard oil or groundnut oil?
Well, there is no one thing which is healthier. I did not mention that. There are certain good points in this and good points in this, so we should rather use the combinations of these. Mustard oil has better omega-3 levels. We have very few sources of omega-3, mustard oil, rapeseed oil, canola is a low erucic acid rapeseed oil only, and we have nuts and oils, seeds like flax seeds, chia seeds, and walnut, etc. For non-vegetarians, fish liver oils. Now, for vegetarians, we have to bring in omega-3, and for that, we must use certain oils which are rich in omega-3. And palm oil has its own positive points with respect to its stability, which was mentioned, its impact on, you know, preventing cardiovascular disease by preventing thrombolytic activities or clot formation. So if we combine the 2-3 oils with a sort of, you know, proper proportion, we cannot have one single, there is no single oil which can provide us all the essential fatty acids. Oils have two functions over here. One is, of course, energy and palatability of the food, and second is the essential fatty acids. So from that point of view, we should be used to use the mixtures of these.
So ma'am, I appreciate that. I would also like to have a non-diplomatic answer. You know, if I have to choose between two oils, which oil should I choose?
Don't use only one oil. Are we not using, let me tell you, right from the beginning when I was a child, there was pure ghee being used and other oils also being used. So we should use combinations of these. If it is frying, going for the oils which are like, you know, palm oil and all. Baking, yes, palm oil is very well suited for baking. We don't need to hydrogenate it or create trans fatty acids. It's plastic fat. It can be used very easily. So use a combination. Mine is purely, and even this work, I have only and only specified it should be combination of the oils. We cannot get one single oil which can provide all our needs.
Middle class people like us, that we should change our, you know, we buy branded oils, change your brand every 2 months.
Dr. Pasi can differentiate between palm oil and red palm oil, because I think we are interchangeably using both of them, whereas health benefit of red palm oil is quite well established. That's not the case with palm oil. So if you could enlighten us on that.
Yes. Red palm oil, when it is refined, is converted into palm oil. During the process of refining, we have to see what is the process for refining which is being used. If we are subjecting it to heat, etc., then definitely there will be some, but there is only 40-50% which is monounsaturated, oblique polyunsaturated, which can be converted into trans fat. But refining here is taking away part of, I'll again repeat, part of its antioxidant activity, that is beta carotene and the tocotrienols and tocopherols. Leave aside palm oil. Whenever we are buying the oils, edible oils, we must look for two things. One, is it a cold pressed extraction of oil? And is it physically refined oil? It is not subjected to heat, trans fatty acid formation will not be there. If it is physically refined, again, so these are the two things. Palm oil is not bad as, I mean, I wouldn't use that word. I would rather put it, red palm oil is the one which I want to advocate, because I don't want its beta carotene and tocotrienols and tocopherols to be removed. Why are we going in for fortification when we have something which is natural with us, providing vitamin A, pro-vitamin A plus antioxidant? But if at all there are places where they want to use palm oil, I don't know, at least I would again recommend that we should, are we not having the mustard oil which has its own pungent flavor? Are we not having tilal oil which has its own taste and flavor? Coconut oil, it has its own taste and flavor. I did just a pilot work that was mixing palm oil, red palm oil with other edible oils. And what I found, and I gave it to the people who didn't know, it was a blinded. All vegetable oils, palm oil addition families accepted it, except in tilal oil and coconut oil. There the flavors clashed. And my presumption that it will not be suitable in the mustard oil, because palm oil itself, red palm oil, again I'll use the word, red palm oil has a lot of yellow color. Yellow color is not a problem in our Indian culinary practices. We use haldi. But when we mixed it with the mustard oil, that was the most acceptable, because it did not, I don't know, whatever it is, families accepted. But I'm again using, this was only a pilot study. Okay. Maybe we can do a bigger study for
it. Thank you. Dr. Sudhir. So we'll just take one or two more questions because we want to be on time. And this is also a time of food security. It's lunchtime, so we don't want to miss on that. And I don't know what they're cooking on. Samdarshi, can you ask them if they're cooking in palm oil? I mean, if they know they're cooking in palm oil.
ISC is not using palm oil. No.
Not even red palm oil, so that's good.
Neither of them.
I would like to do some kind of mixing if the chair permits here. That I'm looking at two things, and my question is to you, Bhogunaji, that for example, on the one hand, we are looking at the health benefits also of the red palm oil, and then what Madhuri also discussed, that when we look at deforestation and other environmental concerns, they are more in case of small and marginal farmers. And then I'm bringing in the point which was made by Ajay Virji in the beginning, that then is it not that when we are talking about small and marginal farmers, we should make a policy distinction between those who should grow palm oil and those who should not grow palm oil, number one. And number two, those who should not grow palm oil, they should continue to focus on the traditional oil seeds, and they should also get the similar incentive from the government as the producer of palm oil are getting, so that there is a level playing field when we talk about economics of oil, number one. Number two, we retain the health benefits. And number three, we also continue to diversify and move in the direction of, you know, what we call self-reliance or Atmanirbharta. So don't you think that we need to make that distinction in order to protect the interest of small and marginal farmers, instead of having a blanket category of farmers and then, you know, giving wrong incentive to wrong people? Thank you.
I'm not sure I understood your question, because nobody is forcing any farmer to grow X or Y or Z. All right. So it's entirely up to the farmers. If they feel that, it is in their best interest to grow a certain crop, they'll continue with it. All this talk about, you know, that we grow extra rice and we have huge stocks of wheat and rice and we need to, so therefore farmers need to divert to oil seeds and pulses, that's not going to happen. You know, your overall policy regimes have to be, tweaked also. MSPs and procurement, a whole lot of things, let's not get into that. As far as the benefits, because it is the stated policy of government to encourage oil palm cultivation. All right. Now, one of the major stumbling blocks is that till the fourth year, there is no income from oil palm. Right? And therefore, any farmer, whether it's big or small, I mean, no farmer worth his salt will be without income for the first 3 or 4 years, which is why this subsidy or assistance to help farmers tide over this. But at the end of the day, it is for the farmers to decide whether they want to do it or not. And actually, you see, the point is, like she was saying, it's impossible for a small farmer or even a large farmer on his own to do this. It has to be done in a group. You know, volumes are required, scale is required for any such operation to be made viable. And in India, we are replete with instances where when prices are high, oil palm cultivation takes off, and when prices start crashing, and Indonesia and Malaysia past masters at manipulating prices. And our farmers then, because prices crash, and the oil palm pricing formula is such that it benchmarks international prices as the domestic prices for the fresh fruit bunches. Farmers are, and it has happened umpteen times, that they've uprooted their stocks, their plantations. And recultivation is again a long drawn out process. So this keeps on happening. So it has to be done together. So I personally feel that, you know, this crop is actually best suited for corporate agriculture. Now, whether you want to take in corporate agriculture, what are the consequences of that? What are the other implications of that? That is a different thing altogether. But to organize it otherwise is extremely difficult. And the only place where oil palm cultivation has succeeded so far in India is undivided Andhra. You know, basically Andhra now. Nowhere else. And it's not likely to, I don't know whether it's likely to succeed. I mean, that'd be too much for me to say, but that is it. I mean, nobody is forcing anybody to do anything.
Thank you so much. We'll take the last question from Paranjoyji, and please don't ask a question that gets us a court case. So please ask your question.
Thank you, Ajayji. It's wonderful to attend a seminar organized with BKS after more than a year and a half. And I have a brief question for Bahuguna ji and a brief question for Dr. Santosh Passi. Ma'am, after I had a myocardial infarction more than 20 years ago, I survived for 10 years without edible oils. I understand India's per capita edible oil consumption is low by international standards. Would you recommend that large sections or sections of India's population should reduce their consumption of edible oils? That's my question to you. And if I may ask Bahuguna ji a different question. So if one of these laws which have been enacted by Parliament was actually in place, would the government of India be able to impose stockholding limits and ban on futures trading?
Firstly, I would say that to completely take off fat from the diet, as a nutritionist, I will not recommend.
No, ma'am, not fat. Edible oils.
Edible oil is in terms of visible fat. Okay? We have fat in two forms. One is visible fat, another is from the invisible fat, which comes from milk and milk products and others. If it is coming from milk, then also we have saturated fatty acids. But absolutely zero visible fat, I don't think it should be done by everybody. Because where are we getting the essential fatty acids? That is my issue. Energy we can get from proteins and carbohydrates. Why I am highlighting proteins over here is because we have already reduced our activity. With the result, total energy consumption is going down, but protein needs are high. Protein needs remain the same. So we can get carbohydrates and proteins to provide energy even if we don't have any fat. But where will be the essential fatty acids coming? These essential fatty acids, lin and len series, cannot be synthesized in our body. And they have very important role to play in our body. So only for non-vegetarians, some amount of fish and all can add. Some amount of fatty acids as EFA or essential fatty acids can come from our nuts and oil seeds, from even the grains like wheat and pulses. The germ of that will provide, and some will come from milk and milk products. On the other hand, even the palatability of the food is definitely lowered when the fat is not added to that. Yes, regarding reducing the fat, I'm a Punjabi. If I eat parathas every day, if I eat pakoras and samosas every day, the fat intake will be high, because all fried foods have somewhere around 15-20% of fat. But otherwise, normally our fat intake should be nearly 1 kg or 1 liter of fat per month per person.
Thank you.
So that should be our requirement. On the basis of that, for the national requirements, we can always work it out. A little higher for the people who are having more activity, and a little lower for people like us who are sitting on the chair. Thank you.
I mean, that's really clear that when you put it into how much kgs is required in individual, I think so policy for the country can have a basis of being made.
I think we have a requirement for domestic production.
Yeah.
Also,
it's also going in for other components.
That's right.
Also, you know, what nutritionists say today, they won't necessarily say tomorrow. So, you know, what is good for you, what is not good for you. You know, we were told for several years that now, ghee is bad, butter is bad. Now they say ghee is good, butter is good. So it's a bit confusing for ordinary laypersons. But to answer Paranjoy, is the other question. I mean, I think the farmers should withdraw their agitation now, because government has, for all practical purposes, withdrawn one of the laws. You know, the amendment to the EC Act, that law has been
as far as, you know, for all practical purposes, has been withdrawn because government has gone against what they have provided for in that law so many times. So wo to baat khatam ho gayi. I think the farmer should be told this. Ki wo khatam ho gaya.
Please go to Singhu and Tikri and Ghaziabad and explain to
me. No, why should I? Government will do it, na? Government is the one which has done it. So, it is obviously, I mean, like I said, I mean, government knows everything. Like in the morning, I was told that government said that government knows what farmers want. So, government knows at this particular time what is, this is wanted. So, this is it.
This is a good discussion. If any of the panelists want a last word, just a quick comment. Sure, ma'am, sure.
I endorse Bahugunaji's comment that nutritionists go back to on whatever they have been saying. I fully agree, but let's remember the science of nutrition is still in its infancy stage. So, sava so sal, just in the beginning of the 20th century, nutrition as a discipline had emerged separately. So we learn by doing and redoing things. I mentioned in the morning itself when it was commented about curdy oil, and I remember as a MSc student, oh, curdy oil, safflower oil, sulfur. And today I'll say, please, please avoid. You're going to increase the cardiovascular disease incidence. Okay. So tomorrow, if we go back to anything.
Thank you.
Nutritionist on the same footing. We keep going back.
Thank you so much to all the panelists and to the audience for being here. And I would only give a personal anecdote on how nutritionists would change dietary guidelines. Is when I was small, my grandmother, who's passed away nearly 20 years, told me that when she was delivering her children, and that is time they used to tell them only have milk powder was better than breast milk. So this is something that my grandmother told me that happened when she was that age. But and coming to the point that I think the government has best intentions of farmers at heart. I mean, that as a farmers organization, I would say openly, but it doesn't know what is good for farmers. And it cannot know that till it doesn't have farmers on the policy table. So Chandrabhushan ji, I would only want to say nothing about us without us. That should be what farmers should be saying, that all policy must be made in consultation with farmers sitting at the policy table. And regarding the oil palm policy, I don't know if you should have had a question mark there or is it a full stop? So Madhvi, I really don't know if we messed up on the heading on the thing or it was by design. But I just want to say that the data and the classifications we're basing our policy on needs to be, I mean, I don't think so. There has been, that's debatable. Is the data substantiated? Is it is evidence-based? What is evidence? And to the question of who decides what is good or bad, nutritionists, who funds the policies, and where does the money come from? I think that's a much bigger picture of the food policy space. And last point I would say is that policies on food should not be driven by economists. They should be driven by a food systems approach, not just by economic policy. So we just hope that going forward, and unfortunately, my experience of 1.5 years at the food systems summit has been that in India, we do not have the capacity to make a food systems approach for the country. So at Bharat Krishik Samaj, we'll be working on that over the next 1 or 2 years with Nand Kumar ji heading the initiative. And I also want to, because you're talking about nutrition, Bharat Krishik Samaj has a seminar on fortification on 25th. So we'll just send out an invite accordingly. Thank you so much. Madhvi, I think you have the last word.
Yes, a quick mandatory thank you note at this point. But you know, after a long hiatus from these physical meetings, I'm more than thankful to all of you to travel all the way and join us here. Big, big gratitude to all the speakers and participants for this candid conversation. This was an informative and a packed half day. And question, of course, Ajay, we started with a question mark, and I don't think the question is far from settled. It was just removed at a later stage. But I think you'll all agree that we've more or less sort of, we started with the objective of stimulating an informed discussion, and I think we've sort of achieved it. And big thank you to all of you for making that possible. We've also understood that there is a huge scope of research in this area, so that these discussions become more and more informed and we can reach certain conclusions, which we've not been able to do to an extent in this discussion. But the idea was to stimulate that and to identify those areas of research. We will definitely document this discussion and hopefully disseminate it in the right quarters and see where it sort of goes. Thank you, Ajay and CB, for identifying this as an area of that requires discussion at this stage, and also for guiding us in sort of conceptualizing the whole thing and designing the format, etc. Big thank you to Prerna for doing all the legwork, identifying the speakers and reaching out to all of you. Samdarshi for managing the logistics and everything else. And all our colleagues who've supported us in many ways. Chinmay was managing the social media thing for us, so thank you for that. So thank you again, everyone, for coming all the way. We did lose some speakers because of this physical meeting, but we're glad that you were all able to come here and support in this discussion and support our small endeavor.